us in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we have a lot of business here today, and before we get started very quickly, I want to remind everybody to please silence your cell phones, because I just did mine. Actually, I guess we're in the courthouse now. You can't have a cell phone up here, so that makes things a little bit easier from that perspective. Also, don't forget that since this is a morning meeting, the parking patrol for the city of Graham will be out and in force. So you may want to keep an eye on the time, and after a couple hours, if you're still here, you might want to go move your car. Also, I want to remind the audience, I think that we may have people here today who have not been here before, that we have rules of conduct for our meetings, which are available to be viewed online, and also rules guidance for public comments. So with that being said, this is the part of our agenda where we have public speakers. If you are here to talk about the heavy industrial development ordinance and the proposed changes, that will be heard during the public hearing at a later time in our meeting. If you are here for a different matter, which is related to an agenda item, this would be the time for a public comment about that. And I don't have anybody signed up. I don't have the book.
We don't have anybody signed up.
Oh, okay, well, great. So since we have no speakers about agenda-related items, then I guess we don't have any commissioner responses. So next is approval of the agenda. We do need to have a minor thing to take care of. Sheriff Johnson has been called to court, and he needs us to move his budget amendment that is currently item 9, number sub 1. He has a budget amendment for the sheriff's office, and we need to move that to, I guess, right after the consent agenda, just before the public hearing. So if I could have a motion to amend.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to amend the agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Then I would need a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and second to approve the agenda as amended. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, next up is the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. Now, if Sheriff Johnson would come up and tell us about his budget amendment.
Thank you very much for putting me up. I'm better than going to jail and fine over there by 10 o'clock, they said.
They just lock you up.
I'm requesting the commissioners allow me to move $173,480 from line item and ICE over to salary line items to be able to give my people that from 1 year to 5 years service a $500 bonus, and five more years, $750 bonus in November. The reason is because our people are going way and be above and beyond what they're supposed to be in that jail holding federal inmates, ICE, U.S. Marshal, and everybody else. And these people deserve it, I can tell you. And I'm asking for the commissioners to give me the opportunity to move that money over.
Yeah, I support that, but let me ask, you know, there's a list of things that ICE says the money can't be used for. Is that clear of the hurdle?
You can use to pay overtime and salaries for it.
Okay. So that clears the hurdle.
Yeah.
All right, good.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the sheriff's budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Before you leave, Sheriff, where are we as far as how much has been brought in on this so far?
Total of $3,626,617. Wow.
Can you say that again?
$3 million. Now, let me say this. A lot of that money has gone to the things that they said we had to do. There's also a lieutenant's position that's paid out of that, and there's also 8 transportation officers paid out of that.
And it was $3 million what?
$626. $3,626,000.
But that's not going to their salary.
No, Lord, no.
Yeah, everybody's going to be confused.
So that's correct, Commissioners. The funding that the sheriff's asking to budget this morning for his employee bonuses is the revenue that's come in above and beyond the cost of operating the ICE program. So the funding the sheriff's quoting, that's the dollar amount it takes to run the program. This $173,221.63 is above and beyond that.
So beyond what it costs.
That's correct.
Meet the requirements of ICE.
And so we got a lot of people that y'all know that work there that are overtime exempt, that's making trips, picking up, doing all kinds of different things. Our people are working real good together to make this happen. Also, I'd like to let you know that the crime rate from 2018, we just got the statistic 2018, is down in Alamance County, and I think it's because of some of the things we're doing as far as holding these individuals that are criminal.
What have the numbers been, can you say, roughly? The numbers of people that we've brought in?
Oh, shucks. we're holding any, I'd say on the average, just ICE, we're averaging about 50 to 60 a day, we're hoping, for ICE. And then the marshals and additional, anywhere from 50 to 80 some day.
And Commissioners, you remember we negotiated a contract with ICE that had a guaranteed minimum, so no matter how many ICE detainees the sheriff holds, we have a certain amount that we are paid regardless. So I think they're holding very close to it. Right at the guaranteed minimum, if not above.
Exactly. Say one day we may have, say, 35. Next day we may have 55. It balances.
But they do the same no matter.
Right.
That's correct. Exactly.
Did you see where the sheriff of Mecklenburg County let go somebody ICE has said hold? You know the story on that one?
I know the complete story.
Can you give us a couple sentences first?
Let me tell you, released one day, and before he hadn't been out of jail 5-6 hours, and he about beat a woman to death, and then held off the SWAT team for about 8 hours. That's why we're holding those people here in Alamance County, is because to protect our society. And those are criminal, illegal aliens that we hold, not just those that don't show up a hearing for being crossing the border.
What's the status, as you know, of the sanctuary city legislation in Raleigh?
Well, I can tell you, the sheriff sit on the desk down there, and we're a little ill about that, but Senator Tom Tillis, I don't know if you noticed, has submitted that bill that says that if you are a sheriff or you release an individual that is supposed to be held on retainer and he goes out and physically hurt someone, the family can turn around and sue the county and the sheriff. And I think that will pass. I may be wrong.
Tell us about big changing his way of living.
Let me say that there was about 15 or 20 sheriffs that went to see him in Washington, North Carolina.
Good. It's election time.
Let me tell you,
that's why he's changing his stripes.
Well, I think, Washington, D.C. is Washington, D.C. They don't have to deal with the stuff we have to deal with, the sheriffs have to deal with. And I think their eyes got open when those sheriffs got talking about the problems that we were encountering as far as criminal activity and stuff. And
I hope he's a one-term senator.
Do what now?
I hope tell us he's a one-term senator.
Maybe. That's certainly up to the voters.
Well, we've got a lot of people here who are waiting for the public hearing to start, so we should move on with that. So the next item up for business is the public hearing on the revised Alamance County Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance. I need a motion to open the public hearing.
I move. Second.
I have a motion and a second to open the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, so before we start inviting speakers to the podium, it's very tempting. We're all Americans, and we love to cheer on things that we agree with and that our team, you know, our side. But in this kind of proceeding, that's not really useful or helpful. We're not on teams or sides here. We're all on the same side and the same team. That's what's in the best interest of Alamance County. And that's one reason I would ask you not to applaud between speakers. Another reason I would ask you not to is because it's actually against the rules for conduct in a commissioner meeting to applaud. And then the third reason I'd ask you not to applaud is because that you'd be surprised how the applause time adds up. And we have people here who are waiting to speak who are trying to get to work after they speak. And we're very sensitive to the fact that people are so engaged in their local government that they would make time out of their day to come to a commissioner's meeting to make their voices heard. And we especially want to be respectful and help them to get to their activities, whether it's a doctor's appointment or work or whatever. So that being said, please do not applaud between speakers. The way this is going to work is I'm going to start on this side of the room, my left, your right. I'm going to ask everybody who wants to speak, who's on the front row, to go ahead, when I ask you to come to the podium and make a line. Each person, before you speak, please give us your name and your address so that that will be recorded in the minutes. And then after that row is finished, then we'll go to the next row. And if you're not here to speak, then don't get up and get in line. Just if you're here, though, and you want to be heard in the public hearing on the heavy industrial development ordinance, then that's how we're going to do it. So we'll go row by row, this side first, and then my right, your left, after this side of the room, and then anybody who's in the overflow room will be able to come in. And I would like for the public to know that generally during commissioner meetings, county staff sits in the meeting room, and the county manager and I discussed that for this meeting and asked that the people who are here to be heard on the public hearing have the space to sit in here to make the process flow more smoothly, and we asked the county staff to sit in the overflow room. So it's important to me that the public know that we listen to you and we try to accommodate your reasonable needs, okay? So, did I miss anything? Do any commissioners have anything to add to that?
Well.
So we'll start with Mr. Bruce Nelson and the rest of this row. If you would come up and if you're here to be heard. Oh, okay, we have somebody. He's going to see this place. But if y'all would please come make a line behind her so that we can proceed smoothly. And I did forget to mention that a public hearing is different from a public comment period. Public comment periods, each speaker gets 3 minutes. But in a public hearing, you get 5 minutes, so there's a little more time. So with that, please introduce yourself, and we're happy to hear what you have to say.
Bruce, is nice to be a gentleman and let a lady go first. I'm Pam. Thank you, Bruce.
You're welcome.
I'm Pam Allen, Causey, Quakenbush Road, Snow Camp. Thank you for spending this past year listening to us, especially those of us who received a certified letter 1 year ago, informing us that plans for a crushed stone quarry had been submitted to the state for a permit. We learned that this had happened because Alamance County was, at that time, a soft target for such applications. I'm optimistic that changes are being made to strengthen that process. 1 year ago, I had never heard of HIDO, even though I'm a retired high school teacher and a business owner. Why do I care about the outcome of this ordinance? Because I grew up in Snow Camp on Quakenbush Road, very close to an active soapstone mine 71 years ago. There was no HIDO then to protect the residents, and especially the children, from the diesel exhaust, dust, blasting, and who knows what else from the operation. I played on the playground of Sylvan School with an active soapstone quarry a few miles away. I'm a survivor of two different cancers, and one of the reasons I had to be first is I have an appointment with my doctor this morning. I am a survivor. However, my older brother lost his fight with lung cancer a few years ago, and he was never a smoker. Is there a connection? I don't know. I ask you to consider your responsibility and opportunity to safeguard the health of the county's residents as you put a new HIDO in place. Now, why am I asking more of you? When I received that certified letter 1 year ago, I discovered that you all didn't know anything about this request. For this reason, I would like for you to, in some way, be able to be informed about the heavy industrial permits and review them before it gets approved. As you work in the next few weeks to revise and prepare the final version of the HIDO, could you also please consider my personal concerns about including the following items? Because all five of these hit me directly when I was being next to the quarry person. First of all is groundwater. Shouldn't a potential heavy industrial business that's going to be using a lot of water be required to do a survey of effect to groundwater on adjoining properties, especially when some areas of the county depend solely on well water and have no backup water supply in the community? Number
keep
two.
Going, ma'am.
Okay. Number two is sediment and erosion control. Was that my 5 minutes?
No.
Oh, okay. Okay. Number two is sediment and erosion control. Who controls what's going to come downstream in the creek that crosses my property on its way to Jordan Lake? Number three is the pipeline and the high tension power line that cross my property. Shouldn't they be as important as a protective facility? Maybe call them an entity for the obvious reasons that I read about each time that Colonial Pipeline regularly mails me a reminder of their safety concerns, of what I should and should not do where that pipeline is. Number four, what about governmental requirements and deed restrictions? Taxpayers shouldn't have to sue to get deed restrictions enforced. If there are deed restrictions, the person buying the property should know about those deed restrictions. And number five, my last request is for transparency. The taxpayers of Alamance County deserve to know the person responsible for desiring to do business in the county, and also to know who is to be held accountable for being a good steward of Alamance County's resources. Again, thank you for your attention to this matter and for this opportunity for us to share our concerns with you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Causey. All right, Mr. Nelson.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Bruce Nelson. I live on Saxbeth Church Road in Graham, just outside of Saxapaw. I'm gonna start with my conclusions and then I'll tell you why I've reached those. First, though, I always say to each of the commissioners, I respect the seat that you sit in. Every view of life I've ever sat in depends on the chair you sit in. And we all sit in different chairs with different views. And I admire the fact that you run for public office. I don't, as you know, always agree with some of the decisions you make, but I respect the process. I really do. And I respect the fact that you put yourself on the line to be in front and center to the county and responsible to citizens. I do. I wouldn't do that. I just plain wouldn't do it. And so I thank you for doing that, and I thank you for the diligence you put to what you do, because you're not paid extremely well to do it. And the responsibility that you have goes far beyond your pay. And I recognize that from the chairs I've sat in my life. I'm not going to speak to all five things on that Pam pointed out. I'm going to talk about water. And why am I going to talk about water? I'll tell you in a minute, because it's vital to my success as a business, which I'll talk about. I think it's reasonable that HIDO applicants should be required to do a study that will detail how much groundwater they're going to consume, what amount of groundwater is safe to withdraw and sustainable in the immediate use, but also downstream. I can tell you that corporations try to put things downstream. Ask yourself why a textile mill in Saxapaw is on the Haw River. Really simple, 100 years ago. Put the effluent pipe in the Haw and send it downstream. Ask yourself why corporations don't want to pay healthcare costs. Really simple, send it downstream. make the participant do it, make the emergency room do it. That's the idea of corporations. They have to maximize profitability. It's no different with groundwater. Two, I think applicants should be fully identified who they are and who's legally responsible, and provide liability assurance if necessary. I am a small business owner. I've chosen to live in North Carolina. I've chosen to live in Alamance County. And I've chosen to make my life savings investment work here in a small business. I opened a small cafe, 48-seat cafe. Some of you have been in it. I applied to sell wine and beer. It's not an ideological thing. It's just customers that come in would like an occasional glass of wine, an occasional glass of beer, and it's a very small percent of our sales. As an owner, to get that license, I had to be fingerprinted. I had to provide my social security number. I had to have a photo ID and prove I'm a U.S. citizen. I had to have a criminal background check. I had to be personally interviewed by a deputy sheriff at the deputy sheriff's office to find myself worthy of a license. Why? They wanted to know if something went wrong, who was accountable. I think that's a fair thing for anybody that wants to do business in this county. That extensive, I don't know. But who they are and what they are and what their background is, I think that's reasonable. I don't think there's anything in our Constitution that says that's not a reasonable request to ask. And then finally, I think, because I hear in the process of deciding how this works, I think it's vitally important that you as commissioners hear HIDO permit applications and vote. Because that's transparency and that's accountability. If you give that accountability away to volunteers or non-elected officials, there really is no accountability. So why do I care enough? Well, my family has a vested economic interest in this county, as well as the quality and the flow rate of water. Why? We own a 400-acre multi-species animal farm, including one of the few remaining dairies in this county. We are first-generation farmers. This is not inheritance. This is family savings, saying we want to make this a better place to live. We employ between 5 and 10 people year-round. All of the water from our animals comes from 2 deep wells. From where that water comes from, I know not. I don't know if the quarry is going to affect the water, but I want to know, because the quality of the water and the flow of the water is vital to animal health. A little bit about animals, if you don't know. A dairy cow drinks 40 to 50 gallons of water per day. In the heat of the summer, that's 80 to 100 gallons per day. 88% of a dairy cow's nutrient intake comes from water, not from hay and not from grass. And that water quality and that flow is essential. If there's no flow, cows, like humans, fight over water. And when they fight over water, they quit drinking as much and they're not as healthy. We have about 100 dairy cows. Beef cows require 10 to 15 gallons of water a day.
5 minutes. Okay, I'm sorry, Mr.
5 minutes. In the essence, I'm asking you what to do what's right. And do what's right is demand transparency and get some protection for the citizens of Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. And so, Mr. Walker, is that going to be our signal that time's
up? I think we got our clock fixed.
You have it fixed. All right. So we're good to go. Right, thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm Mike Dunning. First time I've ever spoken to this group. And some of you who've known me for years may be surprised to know that I have an address set on Greensboro Chapel Road in Snow Camp, as well as one in Burlington. And I've watched events over the last year, and my friends and neighbors have forced me to come off the shelf and come speak to you this morning. So nice to see you, Tim.
Yeah, good to see you, Mike.
As you know, I'm a fourth generation in Eli Whitney, actually, or Snow Camp, I should say. I have a Snow Camp address. My mother was a Hargrove, who we had a dairy farm there for many years. And this address in Snow Camp I want to come back to in just a minute. But 20 years I spent working in community banking, supporting development in economic development in Alamance County, and I still do. I'm thankful that you guys are considering revising or revisiting this ordinance and making it prudent in an effort to continue to grow the county. A lot of my friends don't live here. A lot of our brightest move away. And that's especially true in the southern part of the county, because you've got to go a long way to find a job. So we're thankful. And Bruce and I are pretty much on the same page with regard to things that we'd like to ask you to please consider. I'm thankful the notice is a big deal. I think it's a great idea that we get notice. That's fundamental and important. I truly hope that you'll continue to provide or retain the authority to give us the proper representation throughout the county as we look at future opportunities to develop. And I also like the spacing requirement. But just like Bruce, my key thing is the groundwater part. As far as I'm concerned, I don't believe that the county provides any water, and I don't know what recourse those of us who depend on it will have if we lose it, unless we want to live in a post-apocalyptic type world. And then you'll have people beating on your door asking, can you provide us water? So I think that is something that certainly deserves a lot of attention. And from what I understand, you know, Bruce is right. I mean, we built massive reservoirs in my lifetime to support industries that require water. I don't know what happens if you take that much water, the equivalent in the case of this mine of perhaps a textile mill from the ground. And I think it needs to be addressed. I don't have an objection to industry taking water, but I think the rest of us need to know how it's going to affect us. So I strongly support that. These other items, you know, I'm not so sure I'm smart enough to know about some of the regulations regarding sediment and other things like that. But I guess to you, Steve and Tim, you guys were trained as I was when you did business with people in your former lives. And character of who you're dealing with is critical. One of our four C's, right? I think, you know, there might be some opportunity. I want any, if you're a felon, I don't object to you having an opportunity to grow a business and support the county and such as that. So I think, you know, I represent the difficult decisions that, I mean, I understand the tough decisions you've got to make, and that's a subjective thing to consider character. But my hope is that we'll entertain perhaps some bonding. You know, there's some liability coverage was mentioned by the previous speaker. There ought to be some opportunities for us to protect you and your decision making and those of us who are going to live with whatever is promised by those who want to develop our county. So those are my two requests that I'd like very much for you guys to consider. And Eddie, you might appreciate this. And it kind of dovetails on what Bruce spoke about with his liquor permits, or excuse me, beer and wine, whatever it is.
ABC permits.
I fourth generation snow camp. Go to church with these people behind you, right? Want to move back down there. It's been a lifelong goal of mine. My kids are grown. I went to Western with yours. And that's the goal. We've got a contract with Harold Hargrove to build a house. $162 a foot is kind of stiff these days, I would say. But what's the first thing I did about a year ago is I drilled a well, right? Because I'm not going to spend the money to build that house
and
die because I, you know, without water. I'm still haven't started. As I watched the events that have unfolded here recently, I don't know what's going to happen to my well. But like the beer and wine, I went through a lot of process with the county. They were interested in making sure my well didn't get contaminated, and I paid for the permits to drill it.
Right.
I would hope that you would protect it with regard to this ordinance going forward. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dunning.
Best Carolina fan ever knew.
Tough weekend.
Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Tim Mulrooney. I live on White House Court. And thank you for your opportunity to speak today. I am Dr. Timothy Mulrooney of 9065 White House Court. And our property is adjacent to the quarry site on three sides. So we're surrounded. The past weekend of October 26th, 27th, our household experienced 2 days of drilling noises, dust and disturbance of our home. Our dogs were on edge, barking and refusing to go outside. Constant noise was loud enough to penetrate closed doors and windows. As I understand the parameters of the quarry issue at present, limited drilling for testing is allowed. It has come to my attention that the drilling heard was to install 6 to 8 inch well pipes, clearly in direct violation of the parameters set. This is a clear indication of the veracity of this company. This leads me to the constant flow of inquiries of the availability of sale of our acreage and home. In October 2018, I was visited in my home by a realtor inquiring as to whether we were interested in selling our home. When I asked who was interested in purchasing our home, the realtor stated he could not disclose the purchaser or the proposed use. Since that time, we have received calls, emails, and snail mails, inquiries at least once a month, sometimes more than once, with inquiries originating from multiple realtors from around North Carolina. Why so many inquiries and why anonymously? Is it a coincidence we live right next door to the proposed quarry? None of our neighbors are getting these requests. What are they planning to use our property for? My last point is in regards to the hideout. I feel the applicant needs to provide in detail how much water will be used. If surrounding wells to the quarry are depleted, whose responsibility will be to replenish the water supply to the surrounding residents? Who will be responsible for re-drilling the dry wells? As residents of Alamance Canyon, we trust our elected officials, you guys, to protect our homes. That responsibility is clearly placed in the hands of our elected officials to protect our way of life and all that is needed for life. Many of us have invested our time and services to Alamance County, have entrusted the elected officials to do the same. And I just like to say, you know, my wife and I both retired and chose, as people here have said, to come here to this beautiful Alamance County, and where to live. And we'd like to somehow maintain that lifestyle with not having to worry about redrilling our well. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Mulroney. All right, the next row, anybody who wants to be heard, please come forward.
Well,
good morning. My name is Morgan Seam, and I reside in Snow Camp on Spanish Oak Hill Road. Moved here about a year and a half ago, seeking a quieter and more peaceful lifestyle. The atmosphere of downtown Raleigh had just worn down my nerves. The constant noise of trucks aggravated my anxiety and heart rate, and the chlorine in the tap water had damaged my skin and eyes. I came here because I wanted to be in a quiet place, and I wanted to be on well water, safe, clean well water, of course. And I understand that the commissioners cannot be blamed for the permit issued in Snow Camp to the mining company, as the former Hydo provided no oversight by elected officials or public notification. So I'm really grateful that the commissioners have supported the revision of the Hydo, making it more transparent to the community and showing that you value the citizens as much as the prospective industries who would like to take advantage of our resources and our lenient permitting requirements. I am pleased to see that traffic review, public notification, and final approval of the permit by the Board of Commissioners are now included in the Hydo, along with spacing requirements that do not allow easements to private properties without the homeowner's knowledge. In addition to these measures, and based on my experience in Snow Camp with the proposed mine, I would like to suggest the following also be included. My biggest concern regarding the Hydo permit issued in Snow Camp is the lack of protection from the risk of blasting near dangerous pipelines and high voltage electric lines. These can be jeopardized just by traffic and land disturbance, as has happened along the Colonial Pipeline with deadly consequences. In the new Hydo, the applicant is required to maintain a 1200 spacing buffer, but from the property line to a protected facility, but does not include pipelines and utility easements. I believe that the revision should include utility easements and pipelines as protected facilities. I'm also concerned about allowing the concealment of the identity of the owners for unknown companies recently registered outside of our state and with no identifiable assets in our state. I don't know of any other permit that does not require the identification of the party who has legal responsibility for the company. There is no way to assess the capability, reliability, or integrity of the persons who are issued a Hydo permit for a highly invasive and dangerous activity right next to homes and families. Companies that apply for the most invasive operations with the highest risk to our community members must identify themselves and show that they have experience and a good track record in performing the specified activity. A Hydo permit is a serious matter and should not constitute a learning process at the expense of our citizens. For any new company who lacks prior experience in a highly skilled and inherently risky business. Along with my neighbors, I am concerned for our wells The state has conducted a survey of wells that might be impacted by the proposed mine in Snow Camp so that we can recognize when we lose water or water pressure in our wells due to the mining operation. Does it not make more sense to require a groundwater study of the site in advance of issuing the hydro permit using testing procedures that are industry standard to prevent this from happening in the first place? I just really appreciate your consideration and your time and your effort on this.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, anybody else in that row want to be heard? Looks like not. How about Bill Poe's row? Lee Isley, anybody back there wants to be heard on the public hearing? And since we just have one speaker from that row, we'll go to Henry Vines' row. If there's anybody on this row that wants to be heard, if you go ahead and make your way and form in a line, that would be expeditious. Thank you. Go ahead.
Good morning. My name is Elizabeth Lozick, and I reside in Snow Camp at 8378 Holman Mill Road. 6 years ago, my husband and I found our little piece of heaven in Snow Camp and founded Marley's Meadow Farm and Sanctuary, a 501c3 nonprofit sanctuary for horses, donkeys, and other animals. Let me tell you what we have discovered and appreciate about Snow Camp. Snow Camp has much to offer those who value serenity and a healthy life, whether you are retired or raising a family. Nestled between the Triad and Triangle regions of North Carolina and close proximity to growing Pittsboro, Snow Camp is North Carolina's best kept secret. Growth is inevitable and needs to be well planned to preserve and enhance the quality of life and resources that those of us in Snow Camp and other growing communities of Alamance County's countryside value and treasure. The proposed blasting quarry threatens to rob us of our precious groundwater, clean air, serenity, and plummet our property values. I understand that the commissioners cannot be blamed for the permit issued in Snow Camp to the mining company, as the former Hydo provided no oversight by elected officials or public notification. I am grateful to the commissioners that they have supported the revision of the Hydo, making it more transparent to the community and showing that you value the citizens as much as the prospective industries who would like to take advantage of our resources and our lenient permit requirements. I am pleased to see that traffic review, public notification, and final approval of the permit by the Board of Commissioners are now included in the HIDO, along with the spacing requirements that do not allow easements to private properties without the homeowner's knowledge. In addition to these measures, I would like to suggest the following be included. Our well is approximately 1 mile from the quarry site, and with the aggressive dewatering rate to a depth of 325 feet, we are concerned about our well, which was drilled to a depth of 325 feet just to reach water and provide us with the mere 2 gallons per minute that we, and more importantly, our donkeys, horses, and other animals depend on as the only source of clean water. In that, there are studies that can be done to forecast the impact that dewatering would have on local wells. I would like to see a site-specific groundwater study included as a requirement under the revised HIDO. These studies are apparently common requirements for industrial ordinances in our neighboring counties, even when the industrial activities meet the criteria of zoning. As we have no other access to drinking water other than our wells, we need a layer of protection from any industry that would alter the water level in an aquifer that might also communicate and supply our well. I consider a site-specific groundwater study an important component to obtaining the permit. And with regard to the proximity of a blasting operation next to a liquid hazardous pipeline, utility easements, including pipelines and high voltage power lines, should be included as protected facilities and be protected with the maximum distance under the spacing requirements. Thank you for your time and consideration to my comments.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Morning, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and I live at 3450 Isaac Drive in Snow Camp. Commissioners, I know today that y'all are facing an awesome responsibility. As a farmer here in Alamance County, I have some concerns about the hydro. The water usage that's been talked about has been a concern for years, even in agriculture. Trying to regulate the use of water for, you know, for chicken houses, for poultry operations, cattle, even to the point of putting on meters on to our wells. We have fought this, you know. The use of water is underneath your ground, and it should be your right to use what's on your property. I understand the concerns of each and every one here, you know, of not wanting to have one of these industries in their backyard, but so many things we have to have in our society, we want them, but we just want them in our backyard, you know. But, so it's got to be somewhere. And the restrictions of property rights for owners, we have to look at each and everybody's rights to allow them to operate on their property like they want to govern other people's, what they want to use their property for. And if each individual buys property, if you want to sell your property and you don't want to know what it's going to be used for, that's your right. If you want to know what it's going to be used for, that's your right too. But I don't think that it's the right for the government to tell you what you have to disclose, what you want your property with. If I offer you $1 million for your land and you want to sell it, I'm going to take it. You know, so I think that's up to each individual as to who they want to sell to and how they want to sell. Also, I think that the other thing is, you know, the restrictions of 40 acres of a minimum is absurd. When we know it's going to take a minimum of 120 acres to even meet an operation, it's going to take a minimum of 80 acres to beat this 500-foot buffer. So, and each one of these, if you do the math on all that's in there, is a minimum of what the required setbacks would be, not the operation itself. And I think we should make whatever a hydro operation own the property that they want, and not require to go out from a property line 1,000 feet and determine, well, am I encroaching on somebody's property? If you got a 500-foot setback, that's a football field and 2/3. And they require sound barriers and buffers on that property as well. Make these operations operate within their confines or their complex under the rules and guidelines. The 500-foot buffer with no usage is, you know, that's 80 acres that a company or whatever is going to have to buy. The other thing I look at is, what kind of message are we sending to other industries with these kind of restrictive requirements that we're asking? Are they even going to come in here and say, well, if they've got these kind of restrictions, what are they going to do if we come in and want to build a big manufacturing plant here? They won't even look. So we have to look at all perspectives of this thing. And as an advocate for zoning for over 30 years, we should have done this, and we wouldn't be standing here with this problem right now. I know we were trying to address the issues that's been proposed because of the rock quarry, but we don't want to overextend, I think, overprotect, and I don't think we want to underprotect as well. But as you make your decisions, I hope that you'll take these into considerations, you know, the property rights of individuals, the water use. And my thought as a farmer is, if this is happening because of this, what's going to happen when somebody moves into, they have to make a big development and come and say, well, we want those chicken houses closed because it's causing our property values to go down, or working land. We have to look at these implications. We have a very favorable board here, the Board of Agriculture, and I appreciate that. And I appreciate the fact that agriculture is exempt from this. And I thank you for your time.
Yes, sir.
Good morning.
My name is Jimmy Benton, and I own some property in Snow Camp, which we bought in 2002. We've been planning to build a house there when retired, and I retired this past September, so now I'm ready to build this house. These plans are now on hold due to the planned gravel quarry, which would be located about a half a mile from our property. It's been interesting to attend the commissioners' meetings in the past few months, and I'd like to thank the commissioners for everything they've done for us in those few months. In particular today, I'd like to thank the commissioners for taking the responsibility for granting final approval for all the new heavy industrial permits. I think it's very important to have elected officials make these decisions. Also, I think that the new provisions that clarify the measuring of spacing requirements from the property boundary are a good move and will be of much benefit to people who live right next to any property where an industrial situation might develop. I would, however, like to voice my concern over some of the environmental provisions that are still lacking. My property is on a large pond that is less than a half a mile away from the proposed quarry site. This pond is almost completely spring-fed. I feel that it would be impossible not to impact our springs with the quarry drawing 500,000 gallons of water a day out of the aquifer. And although one of the first things that we would need to do in anticipation of building would be to drill a well, I feel that it would be unwise to do until I figure out what's going on with this quarry. I believe that it would be reasonable and prudent to require a thorough assessment of the effect on groundwater supply and quality from any industrial development, especially in this case where that is the only source of potable water that exists for those in the Snow Camp community. I've heard that it could take as much as 5 years or so to decide this issue if it has to go to court. I just turned 67 and would like to enjoy this property before I get too old if I'm not there already. Another item that needs to be addressed in the heavy industrial development ordinance should be sediment and erosion control. I've always been an environmentalist and I'm all for solar farms, but apparently there's a loophole in the HIDA which fails to address the concerns of neighbors to their properties. I recently heard of a large solar farm at Snow Camp Road and Clark Road is polluting the pond and the land of the adjoining neighbors. Apparently the Department of North Carolina, the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality has recused themselves from any action in this situation. It's kind of surprising how agencies that are supposed to protect our environment all decide not to do anything about these issues. It sure seems that some of the local agencies could take care of some of these problems without us having to go to court, which is something that no small landowner can afford. Again, I'd like to thank you for all your time and support.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Benton. Good morning.
My name's Amanda Dixon. I live in Snow Camp on Holman Mill Road. I'd like to thank you for allowing me the opportunity to come here today and speak. And I also like to thank you for your service and your consideration on all of these matters, especially the No Snow Camp Mine and the HIDO provisions that you've heard, and I don't need to repeat them. But I would like to remind you as a plea of why I'm a citizen of Alamance County and why I choose to live here. And I moved here. I was not born here. My grandmother registered me to vote on my 18th birthday. Matter of fact, she registered all 24 of her grandchildren to vote.
That's a smart woman.
Yes, she was. It was very important to her that we all understood our responsibilities as citizens in this country, that we had the voice, that the government is for the people. She told us to write to our officials. Not only are we to elect them, but they have no idea what's going on in our world, that it is our responsibility to let them know what is going on. I do a very good job of writing our federal and our state representatives, but unfortunately I don't do it well with you guys. I'm sorry, I will amend that. But we are to participate. We are not just to elect you on one day and then walk away. She also reminded us that the government was set up for the people of a free nation. Abraham Lincoln in his Gettysburg Address reminded a torn nation in battles that had been fought and many had died, in order that all peoples of the United States in the past, the then, the now, the present, and the future, that those who gave their lives not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth. See, it's all about the people. It's not about corporations. It's not about LLCs or businesses, money, or the tax base. It is about the people. You sought election on this board to represent the people of Alamance County. And in the opening prayer, you asked God for the wisdom to govern, to make those decisions. It is the people that you are to think of first and foremost. And I'm not sure that any member of Alamance advocate are citizens of Alamance County. Are they invested in our county, or is this just greed? Now, I'm also an accountant, so I look for businesses to make money. But we who are citizens of this area and of the earth are responsible for keeping our earth clean and livable. We haven't done a very good job of that in the last 100 years. Our country, our world, is polluted. But I moved to Alamance County 27 years ago because I lived in Durham County and I had a young son who had chronic asthma. After many stays in hospitals on medications, our physician said, find a cleaner place to live. We moved to Alamance County because it was clean. We moved to Snow Camp because not only was it the air clean, but the water was clean. That means a lot. And as you have heard, many people will move to a place that water, air, and land are clean. They will move away from places that are dirty and polluted. That is your tax base. The people is your tax base. Alamance County is a great place to live. And I tell people all the time, I don't want developers to know where Snow Camp is because I know what they will do. I said, no, I'm not telling you where I live. If we, the people, protect our resources, then the people will live here. Failure to do so will drive them away. I have seen this in Warren County. Maybe you know this story. In the 1980s, toxic waste was dumped along the roadside. I have served in that county as a pastor. The homes are just, they walk away. Banks don't even bother to foreclose because nobody's buying them. The schools are the worst in the state. Those kids are uneducated. They are poor. It is one of the poorest counties in North Carolina, if not the poorest. I would hate to see that happen to Alamance County. So failure on your part is to represent and do for the people. The people will either thrive from it or the people will be destroyed by it. I thank you. The people thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dixon.
Morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sherry O'Connor, and I live on Sylvan Road in Snow Camp. I want to first thank all of you commissioners for the hard work that I know has gone into this new HIDA revision, and I also want to thank the No Snow Camp Mind Group for their continued time and support in the efforts in voicing our community's concerns about the threat of the quarry that slipped in undetected under the former HIDA. My primary reason for speaking at this point is to avoid having to revisit the new HIDO in future years because it doesn't address all of the public concerns. Where there's a great start on a HIDO revision, I share my neighbor's concerns regarding the threat of losing access to our well water, a potential explosion and extreme fire risk from the aging colonial pipeline, contaminated storm water flooding our streams, and the fact that the permitted company finds it necessary to hide their identity. Concern is a mild word for what has truly been a nightmarish string of sleepless nights since we learned of this HIDO permit 1 year ago. I believe that the provisions you have added for traffic control, spacing requirements, and a public hearing are steps in the right direction, but fall short of achieving the level of oversight that is apparent in other industrial development ordinances in our surrounding counties. I realize these counties are zoned and we are not, but that is no reason that we should have an overly lenient industrial ordinance that does not adequately protect the community. If anything, the absence of zoning should warrant more restrictive oversight and certainly not less. I greatly appreciate all of the time and the effort the commissioners have put into this revised HIDO, but also recognize that it is incomplete and does not address all of our voiced concerns. It is a half-measures revision. It would be a shame to miss this opportunity to make all of the needed changes. If time constraints from the soon-to-expire moratorium are the reason for pushing the current draft through, then I ask that you take definitive measures in the next several months to review and craft the additional provisions we're requesting for more comprehensive oversight. As all concerned have put so much time and effort into this revision, it deserves to be completed and taken to a level that addresses all the potential threats posed by heavy industrial development in the heart of our rural and residential communities. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, next row. And what we'll do, since if there's five people, then the last person's having to wait maybe 25 minutes to speak. So within that row, if we could have a speaker and then the next person standing behind that speaker, and then y'all figure it out yourselves who's going to get up after that.
Work the system.
I think that would be more helpful and comfortable, especially if people have trouble standing for that long.
Maybe it's just me. Good morning. My name is Deborah Patterson Sanders. I also have property on, I'm a resident of Snow Camp. I live at 8900 Snow Camp Road, and I also have property on Clark Road. So my property borders on both sides of the mine. First, I'd like to thank you guys, commissioners, for allowing myself and my neighbors, who seem to be everywhere, for having our voices heard. We really appreciate that. A huge thank you for the new spacing requirements that the HIDO, the Center of Operation changes. That was great because it hits me on both sides. And I'd like to personally thank you for actively listening to us and taking a role in this final decision. But we're continuing to ask you for other things, and you know that. So the first is a study of the water consumption for a specific gallon withdrawal regulations for the ratio for the neighboring wells. There on my properties, we have three ponds, and I have water running through, and less than 2 years ago we've had to go down deeper for our well, so I worry about things like that. Okay, there seems to be some inconsistency on the regulations for stormwater runoff. We worry about that. We worry about everything in Snow Camp now. But today the proposed revised HIDO states the applicants is to maintain a 1,200 foot spacing buffer from the property line to the protected facility, but this does not include pipelines or Duke Power High Lines as a protected facility. I believe, and this is just me talking, that this is ludicrous. Why would these two things not be protected? They're highly volatile things, okay? One could blow up and take neighboring humans and farm life with it. The other could potentially cause blackouts, power surges, and fires. I feel this should be protected facilities. In Snow Camp, we have a Duke Power High Line just a few hundred feet from a pipeline. Oh, and by the way, that pipeline runs right by the elementary school. The mine property line of operations is within 1,200 feet of this spacing buffer, and the said high lines and pipelines are right there at it. I can walk out my front door, I see the high line. It's across my pasture, and at night, in the wintertime,
When the leaves are off the trees, I see the steeple of the Baptist Church. It runs right by the Baptist Church, this pipeline does. The other thing I have a thing about is the stricter requirements for the heavy industrial companies wanting to generate business in agricultural areas. I don't know where y'all live. I've lived in cities. I moved back here 2 years ago to be back in the county, back near home, near family. I just think that these people, we need a little more background on. This is not what I wrote, but it's coming from the heart. I'm just a concerned citizen trying to enjoy retirement in a county setting. Never did I think I would be speaking before a county commissioner's meeting, especially a second time. But I realized that everybody has a voice, and we need to do that voice to let y'all know. But I do want you to know that I really appreciate y'all listening to us. I thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Ulickney?
Good morning. My name's Gary Ulickney. I live in Snow Camp, North Carolina. In the interest of time, you all know how I feel about this. We've talked about it a lot, so I'm not going to go into the details of what we talked about today, although I'm very supportive of those five additions. Also want to thank you guys, and in the planning board, I think there's a lot of effort been put into this. I want to echo a couple comments. One of the previous speakers said this is an opportunity, and I think that's a very, very important word. This is an opportunity to get this right, and so we hope you will consider that. It'd be a shame coming back 2 years from now and having to relook at this and to do that. Our state representative, Dennis Riddell, couldn't be here today, but he sent you written comments, so I hope you'll take the time to read those. He echoed some of the comments that were made today. And finally, I just think it's so important that the commissioners are involved in these decisions. I know there's some resistance to that, but I think that can be mitigated in a number of ways through less, you know, consent agendas and things like that. But, you know, you guys ran for office and the buck stops here. And you saw what happened in this situation when there was no oversight by the commissioners. And so I hope you will include that and keep that into the HIDO. And again, thank you guys for your support, and I'm very supportive of what my neighbors have said today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else on that road? All right.
Hey, Ann. Hey there. Good morning. My name is Ann Allen, and I live at 9300 South Fort Bethel Road in Snow Camp, which is the boonies and a blessed place to live. My husband and I retired to Snow Camp over 23 years ago to escape the growth of Raleigh for a slower lifestyle and to return to his county of birth. Snow Camp is God's country. My husband and I feel as stewards of our land, we need to contribute to God's creatures, soil, and water. We cut hay twice a year. We garden our vegetables and fruits and preserve them. We have wood duck boxes on our ponds and on our creek, and we feed them throughout the winter because they come to nest and reproduce. Our ponds are stocked with bass, brim, and catfish, and we also feed them throughout the summer. Boy, my husband has some expensive little stuff. We enjoy inviting the families to fish. Every morning I sit on my porch, regardless of the weather, and watch the sunrise. I listen to the neighbor's roosters. I listen to our neighbor's cows. Mostly I listen to the silence. I watch the deer browse our fields, as I'll do this morning, and drink from our ponds. Most days, a great blue heron or an osprey will visit to fish. Last March, we had a bald eagle that showed up to check out the fishing possibilities. Our honeybees produce awesome honey. Some folks out here, I call our city friends, they've never heard an owl before. Today, it's a daily thing at our house. We are truly blessed. I am concerned about the peaceful and healthy life that we enjoy, as well as future generations will be at risk for us and our neighbors. I'm concerned about the air quality being polluted with carcinogenic silica dust. I'm concerned that our property values and our acreage of Snow Camp will plummet. And don't even get me started about the traffic on our two-lane narrow country roads will be the future of our that the blast mine is allowed. The current HIDO revision does not include provisions for stormwater runoff, as the county does for construction permits located in a designated watershed. Instead of regulating stormwater under the HIDO, the county relies on the state to oversee an important environmental concern and threaten to personal property. Many streams flowing from the proposed mining site drain into creeks across multiple properties on their way to Crane Creek, which goes into the Hall River, which goes into Jordan Lake. Further, it seems that solar farms enjoy a loophole in the HIDO that the state does not regulate solar farms or their stormwater runoff. If it is beyond your capabilities now to implement stormwater and erosion control into the revised HIDO, then that should be recognized as a need, prompting a study to examine other regulations, for example, Burlington and its surrounding territories on how they managed the important consequence of industrial construction. I am deeply concerned about the potential drawdown of my well from the proposed mining operations as they lower the water table over 300 feet. I am terrified about the future of our well with the proposed 500,000 gallons of water that will be used every day by the proposed blast quarry. Our well of 120 feet and 24 gallons a minute has already changed since we have built our home. We've had to put in a complicated water system as the mineral levels were getting too dangerous in the natural shift of the aquifer. I can't even imagine what our water quality will be with the proposed mining operations. Companies should be made responsible for protecting our only water supply and for demonstrating a site study that the operations will not diminish or contaminate our water supply before a HIDO permit is issued. And finally, please not even consider permitting any operation that would entail blasting their gas pipelines that are with the minimum space requirement. That is simply putting lives at risk and irresponsible when you have the opportunity to include utility pipelines and electrical power lines and their easement to the definition of protected facilities. Colonial Pipeline goes through our farm, and their contractors are persistent in keeping the pipeline clean off to warn any future leaks. Common sense prevails in Snow Camp. A handshake is still as good as a contract in these parts. In Snow Camp, some Snow Camp families today have their heritage going back to before the Battle of Alamance of 1771. Thank you for the opportunity to comment on the HIDO revision.
Thank you.
And I didn't go off the rails.
Good morning. Happy November. I am Donna Poe from Snow Camp, and I thank you for the opportunity to comment on the proposed HIDO revision. For more than a year now, I have stood here before you at just about every county commissioner's meeting, asking, questioning, thanking, clarifying, informing, empathizing, and praising God through it all. It has been quite the journey of faith. And what I am most thankful for is how we have witnessed unity in our community, many of who are here today, a blessing that can only come from and glorifies Him. So I thank you, our county commissioners, for your presence and leadership through this process. And I'd also like to thank the Volunteer Planning Board and its subcommittee for the many months of working on the HIDO revision. Prior to this year, I was simply, humbly enjoying my tiny home of 14 years in Snow Camp with my husband and big dog, with plans to possibly add on to our home after my Aunt Judy, thankfully, came to live with us. Those remodeling plans have sadly been put on hold with the threat of a proposed brush stone quarry just 1,500 feet from our back porch, as we fight not only for our future, but for those who can't. During much of my life here in North Carolina, I led a community garden at my church while growing in faith and witnessing to others about stewardship and love for God's creation and His people, to work and take care of His gift, to not waste it or forsake it. It's in sharing all this that I impress upon you the importance of mindfully fixing this bad ordinance, to approve the proposed HIDO as presented, along with the additional suggestions shared here today, and I just gave to you, and by the numerous emails sent to you, I know you've received a few, and to be responsible as stewards and elected officials under the authority of God for the health and welfare of His people, the citizens of Alamance County. And that responsibility would include adding potentially exploding gas pipelines and power lines, power high line, to protected facilities under the land spacing requirement section. We have all seen and heard too many horror stories in the news of recent. It would be senseless not to include, especially with many communities like Snow Camp, having only a volunteer fire department. No amount of supposed extra training would circumvent the potential for property damage, injuries, and the unthinkable loss of lives. Number two, applicant verification. Who are these people? Are they licensed, bonded, felons? We've heard all these questions and fears shared in this room. Number three, groundwater study. Require the applicant, no additional staff needed, to provide the assurance or concerns for proposed water usage. Other counties require this. Number four, sediment and erosion control. We obviously need to do a better job at that after hearing about Stephanie Thurman's three-year debacle, and you'll hear more today, over who's to be responsible with the adjacent solar farm. Since the state doesn't regulate solar farms, then the county must. Push back with complaints of there not being enough staff to enforce an ordinance is not acceptable. Number five, compliance with deed restrictions. All hydro applications should be required to complete a deed search so that deed restrictions, such as the case with my property, that protect residential neighborhoods are not violated without the onus placed on the homeowner to file an expensive lawsuit after the fact to enforce same. In closing, I'd like to say how I'm very thankful for the added public notice requirement as well as the final approval to be by the county commissioners. No more surprises. Over the past year, each one of you has expressed your empathy along with feelings of helplessness to the citizens of Snow Camp in righting the wrong relating to the intent to construct permit which slipped past all of us as a checklist stamped approval by a county employee back in January 2018. You've expressed much frustration, indicating your hands tied to remedy the situation while the county attorney and planning director continue to simply justify the process. It was then to much surprise and confusion to hear the discussions at the 10-20 meeting for the preference to leaving the final decision up to the planning board, all volunteers, non-elected, non-salaried officials with comments indicating there just wasn't enough time in county commissioner meetings to review all the applications for a final approval. I'd like to point out the thousands of hours of research the No Snow Camp Mine Group has done this past year. Commenting at every commissioner's meeting, the expense of an attorney to review the permit issued in error to Snow Camp Property Investments, and to help us understand our legal rights to pursue a judicial determination of what we see as an invalid permit. Essentially putting our lives on hold as we watch for sale signs pop up all over our community, to include personal threats from the bullying mining company attorney. I don't think it's asking too much of the commissioner's time to review and take responsibility for all future hydro permits. We elected all of you, not the planning board, and this responsibility of reviewing and approving heavy industry belongs with you, our elected officials. Thank you again for your time and consideration to this very important ordinance revision. To God be the glory.
Thank you, Ms. Pope.
Good morning, I'm Stephanie Thurman. Thank you for the opportunity to comment on critical revisions to the HIDO in an effort to establish fairness to communities, something it currently doesn't contain. You're aware that my property in Snow Camp has become sandwiched between two HIDO permitted industries, the solar farm and the quarry. Over the past few years, I've reached out to county officials, the City of Burlington, the NCDEQ, and the NC Department of Justice to try to figure out who will protect my rights as a property owner when it's being negatively impacted by an industry permitted by the county. The NC Department of Justice, representing the DEQ, stated that Snow Camp is an unincorporated community, so any regulation of solar facilities would be controlled by Alamance County. Thus, Alamance County government is the appropriate starting point to determine the status of any required permits and or inspections. This is why it's so important that these protections are built into the HIDO and enforced with repercussions for violations by permit holders. Revisions should also include ground and surface water protections, sediment and erosion control, pipeline and utility easements as protected facilities, compliance with other governmental requirements and deed restrictions, and a high level of applicant transparency. The county should adopt the groundwater requirements that the state uses and include that in our HIDO, something that Chair Daley has suggested. It's also important that the commissioners take responsibility for granting final approval for all new heavy industrial permit applications. Additionally, solar farms are considered non-land disturbing industries once they're up in operation, but more needs to be done to regulate their construction, especially when more than 1 acre of land is disturbed during the construction process. This is the general criteria for projects that require an NPDES permit, but solar farms are exempt regardless of their size and degree of land disturbance. In the case of the Snow Camp Solar Farm, over 40 acres of dense forest experienced total upheaval. Considering the slope of the property and knowing how stormwater runoff would negatively impact adjacent property, more should have been done to restrict the amount of sediment leaving the site to protect surrounding ponds. A comparison of 2014 and 2018 imagery of these surface waters from the Alamance County GIS illustrates their diminished water quality, a clear violation of the Clean Water Act. You may recall the pictures I sent you recently of my view of the solar farm and the multiple requests I've made for screening as described in the current HIDO. I was informed last week by the planning director that screening in this area was not included on the approved site plan. Therefore, only the dead trees would be replaced to bring the project into compliance, and that the county, quote, would not be able to ask for anything more than what county ordinances require, and that I would need to take it up with the solar farm. This makes no sense to me. The current HIDO clearly states under landscaping and screening that all industries regulated by this ordinance be required to have a screening plan, the purpose of this requirement is to mitigate the visual impacts of land use on adjacent properties. I'm that adjacent property, and my interpretation is that screening is required in this area. The landscaping on the site plan approved by Libby Hodges is seriously deficient, which leads me to believe that it did not receive a proper review. The solar farm's permit is due for its 3-year renewal inspection, so this, as well as the stormwater erosion, should be addressed. Periodic inspections are necessary to look for violations and make adjustments to bring the project into compliance with the HIDO, not into compliance with the approved site plan. People aren't perfect, neither are site plans and ordinances, but I must say that I've never dealt with planning office personnel who are so unwilling to acknowledge that errors and mistakes occur by simply refusing to take a closer look. It's a pattern that has impacted me with both the solar farm and the quarry. Feedback and input from citizens is a valuable resource and should not be dismissed or ignored. Just because something on paper is submitted by a registered professional doesn't mean it's accurate. And when staff assume that it is accurate with no verification, it's distressing. In an August 26 email, that's how former planning director Libby Hodges said that she handled official documents. In closing, thank you, commissioners, for the HIDO revisions and for the progress made so far. I hope you can agree that more can and needs to be done to protect the rights of Alamance County citizens. Thank you for your service.
Thank you, Ms. Thurman. Okay, solar farm guy. Sorry, I don't recall your name.
I'm Chris Jones, up from Carolina Solar. We're out of Durham, North Carolina, just next door. And I've been here for a lot of these meetings. Basically, I just wanted to thank the Board of Commissioners for holding this public forum, and also thank the Planning Board and specifically Tiny Cattle, who have been probably bothering every week now just about updates of this thing. I think for us, this new HIDO really does work pretty well. It is a little bit more restrictive in terms of the property boundary setbacks than really every other county in the area. It is something we can work around, and I think that does protect the citizens of Alamance County and kind of provides us some room to work with. So all in all, I just think it's a pretty good HIDO. We're kind of excited about applying in the county, and just to address the former speaker, this is very site specific with erosion control and runoff. Specifically our site, for example, is not a cleared forest. It's just a cattle field and actually some farming operations there. So we don't anticipate those types of issues And if there are those types of issues, you of course would catch that within the review process. So another reason this HIDO is really good for everybody. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, sir. All right, Ms. Johnson. All right, getting over a cold, so my throat's a little funny. So I'm Laura Johnson. I live on an Onondaga Trail in Snow Camp, and it's O-N-O-N-D-A-G-A. No one can ever spell it. So I know a lot of what has been said here, or a lot of what I was going to say has already been said here. I think that for me, the two biggest points is, again, the water supply. You know, my farm, my home, if I lose my well water, I'm done. You know, no one's going to want to buy my property. I am obviously not originally from North Carolina, as you can tell by my accent. I grew up in Michigan, and as everyone knows, Flint, Michigan, they're still dealing with that. The city is still providing bottled water on a weekly basis, and it's been years, and there's no end in sight on that. I think that the decisions made and the industries and the things coming in under the HIDO are not something that's just for our generation. It's not something just for your kids or your grandkids' generation. This is your grandkids' grandkids are going to be dealing with the impacts of these. And so that's why it's so important that we really take a look at this. We've heard over and over and over again, once it reaches the state, it's a done deal. And so that means that we need to be making our own decisions. We need to have the information. We need to really be thinking about this and saying 150 years from now, are the people of Alamance County going to be cursing us because we decided to put this in and we destroyed an entire community? I understand the limitations of the staff that our county has, but just like the DEQ, they don't rely on a couple people in an office to make the decision. They go out to different agencies, different experts across the state, and they tap into those to help make that decision. I think our process should have that same thing. We should be tapping into those experts. We should be going for that information. We should gather everything back, be able to make an informed decision here at the county level. Because if we don't make it at the county level, someone at the state's gonna make it for us. I think that, you know, like I said, the groundwater and that is one of the biggest concerns for our community right now, because we just know that this could make us or break us. There's a lot of safety issues, and there are a lot of provisions that could be in this HIDO that would carry us through and protect us as the county is working on the planning, you know, the land use plan for the coming decades and where we want to go. And so I think that is what I'm asking for, is for a HIDO that's sufficient, that helps us make informed decisions, and that carries us through until such time as we have zoning or something to protect us adequately. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Is there anybody else in the overflow room? That's it?
Okay, that's it.
Great. So before we have a motion to close the public hearing, if I could just check with the commissioners and tell you what I'm kind of thinking. So I see us, you know, maybe somebody else will come forward while I'm talking. I see us closing the public hearing, have an opportunity if anybody wants to say anything about the public hearing itself, then having a recess, and then coming back after the recess and taking up the issue of the ordinance itself. Does that sound reasonable to you all? Since we've been going for an hour and a half. And I'll let you know that over the past couple of weeks, I've worked on a draft of the ordinance that I'll give you before we recess. So, you know, if you want to flip through it before we start discussing it, then have that little opportunity. So if that's okay with you all, then do we have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So does anybody have anything that they want to say in response to anything in particular that they heard during the public hearing that they don't want to save for the discussion about the ordinance itself?
Well, I'd like to ask a question. Where a lot was said today, and it should have been, and it's been looked at in the past, all the wells around the property about water. How much studying is done about the blast and the seismic or the, the internet is full of credible articles about how blasting affects the water tables, or how it can cause water to just drive wells and so on. I mean, how much analysis is done with this process, as far as we know what's going on top of the ground, but do we know what's going on underneath? I mean, you have a blast. I mean, it just vibrates, and it's going to vibrate the land, the tables, and so forth and so on. Can I get some comment on that from somebody?
I think I forwarded to the board the seismic study that was done several months ago by the mining company's contractor. And I think those issues were addressed in that study. I can't answer the question of what will happen if a giant fissure opens up after a blast. I just don't know. I'm not a seismic expert. But the 500,000 gallon per day figure was... according to the mining people, when you have a rain event and they have to pump that water out of the hole in the ground, the rock that is the hole in the ground. So the other rock quarries in the area that have been abandoned are giant lakes, and they conducted blasting to get that rock out. So I'm not an expert on it. I'm just saying that it appears that they still hold water after the blasting over, but that is something I would refer the board to, and I can send that to you again. And seismic,
well, hearing a report from the mining people is like reading articles about West Virginia turning in their reports about coal mining and what goes on
well,
up there.
I understand that, but this is an engineer that's done that, and I think the mining commission has reviewed
paid by
it as well.
Who?
I assume it's been paid by the mining.
Yeah,
company.
Got to be a better way. We ain't got to.
Okay, other concerns or comments about the public hearing itself?
I do want to make a comment. I appreciate everybody that came today. Unfortunately, I think this mining deal has somewhat left the station. I mean, it's at the state. I mean, we have our hands somewhat tied. I mean, we can look forward to making this a better product. If I go looking about groundwater control, DEQ comes up, and that's where this permitting is. I'm thinking, is DEQ's looking at it? Is that correct?
That's my understanding, yes, sir.
Which is a state agency, and I know when we went through the Jordan Lake rules here, right here on this planning board years ago, the big issue was, what do we put in our ordinance? And our state controls a lot. What we right here, we think we have some control. A lot of it is outside of our hands. Now, to put it in our ordinance, to do some kind of study on it, I don't know if there is a provision. And I think if we could, on a preliminary, do that, I would much suggest that. But y'all brought up great ideas on the pipeline. Y'all saw how much control we had over MVP, so I'll just stop at that. We didn't have any control. It's going to the federal government. They're going to make that decision that they're coming here. And sometimes that's just what we have to deal with, unfortunately, because we're a state-run government. We're not run. We don't control the state rules. We control our little boundary. And unfortunately, I think the process was totally messed up that we didn't know about this before it happened. You know, that's kind of like looking back. Can we fix that? No, unfortunately. But that's just my few thoughts.
Okay. Well, I'll say that I think we need to, as a commissioner, I think we need to do as much as we can to protect their groundwater down there. Exactly. If there's any way we can add it to our provisions on the IDO, how you pronounce it? We need to do what we can do to make it stronger.
Well, I agree with what you said, Bill. We've got to come up with the best way possible to protect our people today and into the future.
That's
from
right.
The events that we've experienced here. I will make one suggestion to people who want to email us. And we all know we've gotten dozens yeah. probably another thing of emails. And a number of the emails have done attachments versus putting the body of the language that you wanted us to read in the email document. And Mr. Walker back here is going to be one of the first people to caution us from opening an attachment on an email that comes in from outside county email. So I don't know about the rest of you. I don't open them. I don't want to mess this thing up. So if you're going to put something in the email, please go ahead and put the body of your document in your email. We read them, but we're not going to open those attachments. At least I'm not.
I'm not even. I'm not going to open up the attachments.
If it's coming inside the county, that's one thing. But if it's outside the county, we just don't do it. And we had something come up in our last meeting about doing an assessment or an evaluation of the approval process, and Mr. Albright has done some research on that for us. I think he has some ideas on that.
Yes, we've contacted a firm in Asheville.
Can we hold that until the end of the meeting? Because that's not really directly related to the public comments. Is that right?
That was what most of the comments were about, was the mining operation.
Okay.
Well, and a number of the people who are here may not want to stay until the end of today's meeting, too. So I thought that might be something we'd want to bring up now.
I'm sorry about
that.
Go ahead.
He has run a conflict check and has agreed to review the permit. He's with the Van Winkle firm in Asheville. His name is Craig Justice, J-U-S-T-U-S. He's also advised the General Assembly on the big rewrite of Chapter 160D. That occurred in the last couple of years. So he's well versed in land use law.
And 160 is what are you referring to in that statute?
160G is the conglomeration of all development ordinances into one gigantic.
At the state level.
At the state level, okay. Yes. He was the advisor on it. One of the advisors on that.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, before we take a recess, I'll just mention to the commissioners, when you look at the ordinance that I've worked on, you'll see the yellow parts that are highlighted are the changes that were submitted by the planning board approved version, and then what you see in blue is what I have done or suggested, and there is, I'll direct your attention quickly to, and we have a copy of this, I think, for the media and for staff. If you look at page 10, number F, there's a groundwater well study, an attempt there to address that concern. But that needs a lot of discussion with the board. Before we recess, I would like to know, are there any materials that the commission feels like it needs to have in discussing or reviewing this stuff? Is there anything that you don't have in front of you that you would like to have? That we can get the staff to get for you during the recess? Or do you feel like you have everything in front of you that you need to make a decision? Are they good?
I'm good.
Okay, great. Then we'll take a 10-minute recess. Come to order, please, ladies and gentlemen, and resume our meeting. Come out of our recess. What I would like to do, my vision for this discussion would be to, and I'm open to input on this, my vision is to kind of go through the draft that is before you and talk about the changes. We've already had presentation from our planning director about the proposed changes from the planning board, the planning board approved draft. Go through this and take a look at how it differs from the planning board draft, and then at the end, maybe go back to the memo that Ms. Poe submitted with the five items and talk about whether or not they've been addressed in this draft. If so, how, kind of review that, and if not, why. Before we get started, I would like to make sure that the public really understands, and Mr. Albright, help me to be sure that what I say is correct, please. I think that it was Ms. Poe said that the 2011 HIDO is a checklist and it's stamped approval. If a company applying for a permit under the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance meets the items in the checklist, then they get the permit. And I just want to be sure the public understands that that is true with the new ordinance as well. Is that not correct?
That's correct. It was a little more stringent review in the proposed.
There's more stringent review, more stringent requirements. The checklist is harder.
That's right.
It's a more difficult checklist to get through and to meet, but it's still a checklist. And ultimately, whoever makes the decision on whether the permit is approved, whether it's the planning director, as it is under the 2011 ordinance, or whether it's the planning board, or whether it's the board of commissioners, that doesn't change that it's still a checklist. And if the applicant meets the requirements of the checklist, then they are legally entitled to receive the permit, right?
Correct.
So I think that is something really important that the public understands, because this has been a long process over many months with a lot of meetings and people attending different meetings, and I want to be sure that everybody understands that that is the case. So that being said, page one of the heavy industrial ordinance draft, the whereases are just straight from the planning board approved draft. Put in the September 12, 2019 date there because it was omitted on the draft. That's when the planning board voted to adopt the statement of plan consistency, which, while we're on the statement of plan consistency, if the commissioners would know that in the when someone is ready to make a motion for if anybody is ever ready to make a motion for approval of amending the ordinance, then we need to include a statement of plan consistency in that motion, and I have the language to add to that. So that's a detail. All right, so page three, the classes. I have suggested returning, so the planning board approved draft contracted the classes to three classes. I have proposed restoring it to four classes. The planning board had suggested breaking out chip mills into sawmills and paper mills. And I kept those in this. I don't have paper mills highlighted in blue on here, but keeping the sawmill paper mill distinction, and then putting the renewable energy generating facilities and the electricity generating facilities. That's pretty much the way it was under the planning board draft. Having the automobile salvage and storage facilities as a class two, which I believe is in the 2011 ordinance. And then the metal recycling and salvage facilities back in the class four. I believe that the planning board draft had put them as a class one. So,
may I ask a question?
Of course.
On the renewable energy generating facilities, would that be a solar farm, right?
Yes, I believe so. And that's in the definitions as well. Thank you for asking that. Renewable energy facility is defined as a standalone, well, if you can read it, it's a solar, hydroelectric, and wind facilities. And then electricity generating facility is a...
That would be hydroelectric.
Other than solar, hydroelectric, and wind.
Okay. And the reason I asked that question is they would then... under a class one, were they already under a class one? No, the workers had changed it, so they were coming down from a class two. Is that right?
I believe that the 2011 HIDO has solar farms as being a class two. Is Tanya here?
Yes, Tanya. I'm right here. I'm looking it up real quick. So, solar farms were alternate energy generating facility class two in the current ordinance.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
The alternate energy generating facility is a class two in the current HIDO.
Current proposed or the current?
The current.
The current
2011, HIDO. Which is
okay.
It's very complex because we have our current HIDO, we have the planning board HIDO, and then we have suddenly this one.
The Amy amended HIDO.
I hate to call it that. I really do. But
so
yeah,
the
that's
reference made to the solar farm next door to one of our neighbors. Is that you, Ann?
No,
somebody had one next door to them, and they've sent us pictures of that thing, and I just can't even imagine having to deal with that.
Yeah,
and the runoff from 40
runoff,
acres of strip cut land into your pond.
And that's up to for revaluation. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. After that's 3 years? That's what she said. I don't have that right from me.
We definitely need to look at that.
Yes.
Make sure that we need some buffers in there. You know. I'm taking her word for it, so I don't know.
So I don't know if y'all have any comments right now on the classes. The reason that I sorted them back out to these classes is because I felt like we hadn't had a lot of our input has been really focused on the quarry aspect of the class four,
right?
And that the you know, the auto, the metal recycling and salvage, and the automobile salvage and storage, that those have been issues in the past, as I understand it, which have been thoroughly discussed. And I think that their past experience may dictate that it's better to leave those as they are under the 2011 ordinance. I don't know if y'all, does anybody have anything they want to say about that?
I agree with that, the way you listen to that.
Well, that doesn't, I just don't want to see us lessen the responsibility of somebody doing a solar farm. I'm moving it from a two down to a one.
So you feel like we should move the renewable energy generating facilities back to a two?
I think we should.
I do. I think we
should.
I'm good with that.
Yeah. I mean, if somebody's got the ability to abuse the opportunity at one level, let's make it a little bit. I mean, I'm not opposed to renewable energy. Let's just do it right.
It basically was on two, right?
I've been
buying
some that have no barriers, and it's an eyesore.
Okay.
It really is an eyesore.
Great. And we'll make that provision.
So we can move back to the factor two.
Yes. Okay. And then page four, I didn't make any changes. That's still the same area of operations. Definition, page five, there's no changes. Page six, the electricity generating facility, that's that definition that they've added. I have not changed. Page seven, paper mill definition, I've not changed. Renewable energy facility, I've not changed. And resource extraction, I've not changed that. Now, page eight, stream. It concerned me during talking about this quarry process that there were two maps submitted, one map to the county and one map to the state, and they had different streams on them. And understanding why that is has been a source of concern for me. And also, as a lawyer, I like to see things defined in the definitions. And so it concerned me that we did not define stream in this ordinance. And so I added a definition of stream. And I'll read it for those who do not have it in front of them. Stream means an intermittent or perennial stream, pond, lake, or reservoir whose presence and location has been determined by the North Carolina Division of Water Resources, or if it appears on any of the following types of maps: the most recent version of the soil survey map prepared by the Natural Resources Conservation Service of the United States Department of Agriculture, semicolon, the most recent version of the 1 to 24,000 scale 7.5 minute quadrangle topographic maps prepared by the United States Geologic Survey, or a map approved by the Geographic Information Coordinating Council and by the North Carolina Environmental Management Commission. So my intent with drafting that was that our stream map would be the same as the one that's submitted to the state.
Right.
Good for you, Amy. I'm glad you put that in there.
Thank you. Well, I have not, before we started this meeting, I had not had an opportunity to talk about that stream definition with Mr. Albright, our county attorney. And I was wondering if you had any questions or
Looking at it for the first time too, so.
Okay.
That's what she's saying.
I did email it to you this morning, because I know you get to work really early, but
yeah.
I'm sure you have a lot of things to do. But, I used the language that's in actually a Wake County Unified Development Ordinance. I used that language in drafting this.
Yeah, well, at least as you're referring to the North Carolina Division of Water Resources, I think that is the one that the mining commission or any commission with similar jurisdiction.
They will look at the same map that we would look to, so that would be.
I guess I'd just suggest
that. That would be relevant to have the same definition they're using as far as the maps.
Yeah. I'd just suggest to collaborate with you, like you normally would.
My page 10, letter G, stream setbacks actually gives a definition or a guidance on streams, so we might need to alter that if we're going to put a definition.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
stream setback on
page 10, letter G, stream setbacks.
Okay, we've got it as H on ours. I'm not sure. Do you have the draft that...
the revised.
The one...
This is the subcommittee draft I'm speaking
from. No, I think...
it's H on
the one. I don't have that one.
It's H
on your line, Victoria.
I said this morning it's...
carries over the top of the next page.
Do we have to
change the topic or something?
Yeah, that's all been.
Oh, H, I remember.
I hate for you not to have one.
That's okay.
It defines it as a perennial intermittent stream. All
right, so H in your version.
Right. Right, so perennial or intermittent stream. So the definition of stream would clarify what an intermittent or perennial stream means, right?
But it's only allowing for setbacks based on that. So if you wanted setbacks on all the other things, that has to be included.
So are you saying that our current ordinance, the 2011 ordinance, doesn't have a setback from ponds?
It doesn't speak to ponds.
So doesn't defining a pond, lake, or reservoir, including that within the stream definition, doesn't that strengthen it?
But I need H to match the definition so that we're consistent through the ordinance. Just changing up the word to...
So you're going to add that definition to H?
It might be easier.
Is that what you're saying?
I might suggest that you add a sentence to H that says, to the bank of the stream as defined in this ordinance.
Awesome.
That again, Clyde.
Just add the phrase as defined in this ordinance to the bank of the stream, comma, as defined.
As defined in the definitions.
Yes.
That's what you're saying. And that covers it and takes it back to that.
I think it does, but I'm open to suggestions.
I think that works for me.
Do we need a reference to the specific place or just a
no.
Just refer back to the definition of stream is good.
Definition of stream.
Is there anything else about that? I really try hard not to talk over y'all or push this too fast, but I don't want to burn time either. All right, now, under regulations and standards, this is a place that I anticipated some discussion because the planning board had changed how the land spacing is measured from a center of operations to the property boundary line. And they had changed for the class 4, the land use spacing would be 1,200 feet and the operation setback would be 500 feet, which I think everybody, the public comments that we've heard, I think people appreciate that and like that. This is just for purposes of discussion or a reference. What you see there in blue are the requirements of the 2011 ordinance. I put those back in there because I would like for us to discuss the land use spacing and operation setback for the other classes. Because like for class 1, the land use spacing that the planning board suggested was 0, that there wouldn't be any land use spacing. And the operation setback would be 125 feet. So they increased the operation setback by 50 feet, but got rid of the land use spacing. Class 2, the land use spacing was 150 feet instead of the old 500 feet, and the operation setback was 125 feet. And then class 3, they shifted, the categories around, and the class 4 would be the new class 3, if that makes any sense. So you have to remember, take into consideration that some of the categories, the different businesses shifted around and so forth. And so I'd be interested to know what the board thinks about not requiring any land use spacing between class 1 things. So that would be fuel bulk storage, ready-mix concrete suppliers, and inert debris landfills. They would just have 125-foot operation setback under the planning board provisions. Similarly, under class 2, which includes automobile salvage and storage facilities, that would have just 150-foot land use spacing and a 75 and 125-foot operation setback. And I was concerned about this because I've had calls in the last, or a call in the last couple of weeks from somebody who's concerned about a neighbor who's storing cars on his house, and they've got the cars right up to the property line pretty much, and not really having any screening, and kind of some of the same kind of enforcement issues, questions that we've had from Ms. Thurman. And I think that if somebody wants to have an automobile salvage and storage facility on their property, then there should be plenty of space from a neighbor, and there should be plenty of screening and a setback. So
I agree with that.
So I don't know if y'all want to return the figures you see there in blue are returning to the 2011 ordinance. I don't know if y'all want to go back that far and go back that strong, remembering that, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Albright, remembering that this new ordinance changes it from being the center of operations and the 1,000 feet all the way around to being the property line, being the boundary where you start with. And that is a really, really big difference.
Big difference.
So the land use spacing on a class one will be 250 feet from the property line?
That's what it is now.
And
under the 2011 ordinance.
Right, the proposal from the subcommittee's view, why they took the land spacing out is because of some of the things the public had said that they didn't want property owners around to have to feel the impact of what a development would be. So they pulled all the impacts onto the property that the actually application would be on and up the setback so that it would be more of a buffer than the current ordinance would to protect the people around it without them being affected with that land spacing. Kind of two different ways to take it, a larger setback or add land spacing and less of a setback.
And we do have Lee Isley and Bill Poe here, both served on the subcommittee that drafted these things. Would either of you, like maybe Lee,
sure,
like to come up and talk to the board about if we're going to change the classes around but still use the border, the boundary, as being instead of the center of operations, can you talk to us about why y'all decided to recommend what you did?
Right, we were looking at it from a balanced approach, a balance to protecting property and also business development. And so taking that into consideration, those class one uses are least impactful. I think Bill mentioned it was a hear, see, eye test, is that correct?
Right. See it, smell it, taste it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And so those are the least impactful. Taking off the land spacing but increasing the setbacks provide those protections while also helping to develop business as well. It helps our thoughts on this.
I guess I'm just concerned that it doesn't protect the neighbors enough.
We believe by adding those extra setbacks in adds that protection necessary. And that was our thoughts. And also while keeping that balance as well, that's very important to us.
Now, does that provide, and I can't recall off the top of my head, but does that provide for a screening around the property as well?
Yes, sir, screening in the setback areas, that's correct, yes.
Right.
Of two rows of plantings.
So you're looking at 125 feet in your proposed
correct
ordinance versus a 75 setback and 250 buffer.
That's correct. Now, there's also fencing in our proposal as well, along with the increased setbacks, the two rows of screenings.
That's a good idea.
I guess one of my concerns, we heard somebody compare something this morning in the public hearing to a football field. Was that you, Henry? That was really good.
That was
I like that analogy. That's really, that was really good way to phrase it.
And that's the class three uses, right? On the
Yeah.
125 feet is just like a third of a football field, right?
Right.
Plus 25 feet.
Right, but again, just to give you some idea of how we did this, we took these uses individually and looked at the actual impacts of our understanding of the businesses and talking to people in the community by taking site visits to a rock quarry, to a soft mine, to a rock mine, also to Chandler's Comet batch facility, and got some real information from those folks, took all this into consideration, and set those into parameters we felt like were the least to most impactful. And then taking that, looking at the actual business needs and also the protection of the adjacent properties, and being sure that balance was met. Bag the extra 50 foot, and we feel like as that balance, when you take into consideration the screening and the fencing.
So 250 feet and 75 feet is a little over a football field from the operation.
Right.
All the way around. That's a lot of land.
250 plus 75 is what it is now. From the center of operations.
Yeah, it's measured from the center. It's not measured
from the
center.
Not
from there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So we're looking at different measuring space.
The operation, not
the land use spacing is only good for those protected facilities. That's not for everything in the world, just for what's on that list.
Right.
Exactly.
So I'm kind of picturing in my mind a football field, thinking about standing in the end zone and looking the other, down the field. And I'm not sure 125 feet from to think that there's going to be any kind of use there. That's a business kind of thing. If I live in a rural community, that doesn't feel like enough to me.
That's sort of your discretion. It felt like enough to us because, again, our goal in setting forth in this was to try to find a balance. And each business impact is different. Our class one uses that we have in class one are the least impactful uses possible in this ordinance, in our opinion. And by adding the extra setbacks along with the already screening and now adding fencing too, provides that protection in our opinion. Again, it's up to you to make this decision, but our opinion was that it provides the delicate balance necessary for protecting private property and stimulating business growth. And that's extremely important.
I just want to take the opportunity to tell you thank you on behalf of the county. Y'all have done an amazing job. And just because, we might change it or question it doesn't mean we don't appreciate. We appreciate what y'all have done very, very much.
We really do.
Well, it was a difficult process. Myself, Bill, and Ray, we worked long and hard on it through lots of meetings, which required a lot of discussions, negotiations to get to the point where we can provide something to you that you can review today and then take all this that Amy's put together and apply those to it as well. But we wanted to do something that we felt like was best for the county and best for the citizens of this county. And hopefully the end goal is that whatever comes out of this will be that.
I think one of the things we want to guard against is throwing the baby out with the bathwater, so to speak. We don't want to get it to the point where nobody wants to come here and start a business.
Yeah, I'm not sure we don't want to do that too.
So we got to.
Well, that was part of our thought process.
Trouble,
yeah, it's part of our thought process. Right. You look at the class one uses, and those are the least impactful that you have. You go to the class three uses, and our ordinance that we put together, those are the absolute most impactful uses that can affect property around them. Which is the reason for the increased setbacks, to put the onus on the actual business itself and keep it away from the public as much as possible.
I like that idea.
And also adding in the third row of screening as well, adding more buffers to protect from the dust and the other mitigations.
Yeah.
The one thing I would ask, and this is not a criticism at all, but I would ask, so you went and talked to Mr. Chandler and some of the other people, the business owners, which is amazing that you took the time to do that.
We feel like it was important to get all perspectives.
Did you talk to the property owners who lived adjacent to those businesses?
No, we did not. Not those businesses, we did not.
So that might give you a different perspective as well.
I think we've gotten quite a bit of comments from property owners through this process in the past year as well.
Yeah, I guarantee you have.
Yeah, I think y'all have done a good job of what you presented there, and I am in fear if you get over restrictive. What message are you sending out to potential businesses coming here?
Right.
Because that was the issue with the fuel bulk storage when we were working on the ordinance many years ago. We had a local business wanted to relocate, and our rules were so restrictive. They couldn't even stay in the county where they wanted to be, and they're very productive, minimal invasiveness. Class one stuff is pretty minimal. The screening is very important. To me it is, because if you go up and down interstates in a lot of the cities, you see these high walls, and you got thousands and thousands of vehicles going up and down that road every day, but there are people backing up to that. They've screened it. They've done what they have to.
Right.
And screening is as vital as anything. With the right vegetation, you can pretty much stop the sound of pretty much anything.
I think fencing plays into that to some degree too, and that's something we're requesting. It's not in the current ordinance that fencing is strongly suggested, in our revision to you is that fencing is would be required at least around the operations setback area, or operations area, excuse me.
That's a tough one. It really is. I mean, look at that and try and figure out.
I can tell you, Bill and Ray, we went and we had several meetings where it almost looked like we were not making any progress at all. But I knew that we were, because you have to talk these things through. It's a delicate balance. And you have to come up with something that we felt like would best meet the needs of our county, and that's what we came up with. Again, it's up to your discretion whether you agree or not, but that's what we came up with to meet what we felt like would protect the citizens, especially on those class 3 levels where the impacts are so dramatic. But also, again, as I mentioned before, and I say this because I think it's extremely important to also be sure that we're allowing for business growth. Our county is growing. There's going to be needs that we have. And so being sure that we're not over-restricted in some of those areas is really important.
And we don't want those next 40,000 people to all have to go out of the county to work, right?
Right. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What if we kept the land use spacing like the planning board has drafted, class 1 being 0, class 2 being 150 feet, and class 4 being, or class 3 being 150 feet as well? Because they had combined some uses there, and then class 4 being 1,200 feet, but then just increase the operation setback a little bit there to maybe 150 feet, so half a football field.
On which one?
For class 1, 150 feet, class 2, 150 feet, and just add in 25 feet to the 1, 2, and 3.
And then 500 on 4.
Yeah, and keeping it at 500 on 4.
And you add 50 feet on the other 3.
Yeah.
25. Does that sit well with you all?
Yeah.
Okay. How does that sound to
y'all? I've just now seen this for the first time here, so I'm trying to process it as I go here, but...
curious to see if Mr. Powell falls on that, too. Looks like he's thinking about it.
Yeah. This is the newest version.
Right.
This is the plan.
Could you repeat back your changes?
Just add in 25 feet to the operation setback for class 1, 2, and 3.
Okay, so...
In your version or our version? Which version?
So it would be 150 feet operation setback for classes 1, 2, and 3. And then the class 4 operation setback being 500 feet. And racetracks. Let's see, what y'all do with racetracks?
We combine racetracks into class 3 as opposed to having a separate.
It was under class 3.
Yeah, right. Instead of separating it out.
So then you would also use the land spacing at 0, 150, and 150?
Yeah.
And then 1,200?
Yeah.
Okay. So the class, your proposal, the class 1 land use spacing will be what we have at 0, and your operation setbacks will be 150.
Right.
And then class 2, what would your land use spacing be at?
150. Which y'all said.
Okay, and then 150 on the setbacks too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. 150.
What about
that? Is
class
that correct?
The class 3 racetracks, we haven't talked about that yet.
Or they had that combined in there.
Yeah, we combined it with class 4.
So class 3, in your version then, Amy, the straight class 3 would be 1,000 or would be 150 on the...
150 on the land use spacing and 150 operation setback.
To me, that's a fair...
What was land? So, Madam Chair, let me read these back for these gentlemen. On the version, the newest version, the chair's version, for class 1, land use spacing would be 0, operation setback 150 feet. Land use spacing for class 2, 150 feet. Operation setback for class 2, 150 feet. Land use spacing for class 3, just the class 3, would be 150 feet. Operation setback for class 3 would be 150 feet. Land use spacing for class 4, 1,200 feet. Operation setback for class 4, 500 feet.
That's correct.
And then the racetrack.
Yeah, I didn't mention that.
Iron out if we're going to get any new racetracks.
Yeah.
putting that back in perspective, that's still a football field for a class three.
You know, we could make racetracks class four instead of class three.
I think so. That's what we must do as well.
I think that's a good idea.
Noise-wise, that's exactly right.
Yeah. Yeah, let's do that. Let's go back.
You can't do enough setback for a racetrack.
I think I saw a news story this past weekend on the racetrack out in Alamance County, if I'm not mistaken.
You were not mistaken. Noise. That was the news story.
Yeah. Okay, so about a half a mile from the interstate, and we could sit out on our deck at night with trees and houses and hills and everything between us on the interstate, and we can still hear the traffic of the trucks on the interstate. So
stop them all.
Okay, so page three, going back to the different classes, we're going to strike racetracks from class three and add it to class four. And therefore, under our section four regulations and standards, we're just going to delete that class three racetrack thing. And then the minimum lot sizing, I had, the reason that's in blue is because of going back to the four classes. So we can delete the excluding racetracks from the class three language and delete the racetrack class three language of the second sentence. So a minimum lot size would read, no class one, class two, or class three land use regulated by this ordinance shall be situated on a tract of land less than 10 acres in size, and class four land uses shall be located on a tract no less than 40 acres in size. And let me pause here and ask Mr. Albright, do you have any concerns or questions or anything going on over there with your department?
No, no changes. And the consequences of which I'm not sure I fully understand. It would be probably better if we had a map
and
use the land on it and you can actually visualize. I work better with pictures.
I do too.
About things like this.
10 acres.
I do have a question.
Okay.
Looking back at the classifications, the class two and class three were changed from land use spacing to 150 feet for both, and setbacks 150 feet for both. If they're both the same, what would be the why not combine the classes then?
Two different.
Right.
You got three combined.
Right.
So that is a interesting comment.
Because you're going to put them all under the same restrictions.
Class three should be more invasive. That's kind of the thought. Is that right? The higher class don't work.
Exactly. So right now we have just these two in class three.
That was so big because it's measured from the center.
But right now both classes have the same restrictions. And so do we change the restrictions for class three to be more intrusive or just combined? That's to Bill's point. That's where we were at with the three classes. We came to the same sort of conclusion right there in the center.
Which basically you just combined class two and three,
right,
and kept the same setbacks on your original.
Yes, sir. Kind of get that center, that center part there. The uses become kind of similar as far as their impacts go.
Three is four. What we're looking at.
That's correct. And then four, it just is obviously the most impactful. Three and ours, four and yours are the most impactful. Yes, sir.
Yeah. And keeping it less complicated is better.
Yeah, and that's another thought we had, is try to make this as efficient as possible. And the three classes, we felt like not only represented those business uses pretty well, also was what was your comment you said there, a better, I said I use efficient, but there's another word I want to use there to sum that up, but a better representation of those businesses.
I'm really glad that you raised that point because now I'm looking at the uses for the new class three would have waste facilities and sawmills. And I'm not sure that a sawmill needs to be treated like an asphalt plant, so I'm not sure that it makes sense to make that a class four.
Right.
But I also think that a sawmill, and I think Ms. Strawberry has some experience with this, is a lot noisier than an automobile salvage and storage facility.
I don't know, they're pretty much the same.
So,
you get them wrenches going.
It depends on if you use electric power.
Is that what this is?
I was talking to somebody over the weekend who has a neighbor who got a sawmill and put up at their house, and they're doing it for hire. I don't know where it is, but I'm not sure.
They're pretty loud.
150-foot operation setback is enough for
this is y'all.
Yes.
A sawmill.
Class.
Well, on the all, you know, you have different issues. You know, some of them are sound, some of them are noise, and some of them are runoff. I mean,
you got to expect the worst.
Auto salvage, you've got all sorts of fluids coming out of a car left parked on land, and runoff from that can get on a neighbor's property.
That's true.
But you're basically looking at a football field. At 150 and 150.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty wide.
It is. I mean, we took the land use spacing in consideration. Yeah.
And some of these issues too depend on the topography.
That's very true.
I mean, if you're uphill, you're not going to be worried about the runoff. If you're on a slope and you've got a property on either side of the property, you're not going to be worried about the runoff if it's going downhill from that property.
That's true. So I don't know. What do y'all want to do?
Why couldn't we just move the sawmill down to class 4?
Make the sawmill and the waste facility.
I mean, there are different kinds of sawmills. I mean, we're not talking portable sawmills. I mean, that's a minimal invasive type thing. We're going to be there a couple of weeks and saw up what's on the property.
If it's permanent, it's a lot different.
Yeah.
So y'all want to take,
so
get rid of the
distinction needs to be there?
Class 3 and make it a class 4? Make the waste facilities and sawmills, just move those to class 4 and get rid of the class 3?
I think that's a good idea.
All right, we'll do that.
Well, we wouldn't be getting rid of a class 3, though, right? We'd still leave waste facilities in there?
Mm-hmm. Now we're going to move it to 4.
A waste facility into 4 also?
Well, that's up to y'all. I mean, whatever y'all want to do.
I think that's what we need to do.
Well, then we don't really have a class 3, so then we're all back to class 1.
We're still back to 3 classes.
Right.
We're moving 4 into 3.
Yeah. You can get a sound like us when we're moving through this.
Yeah.
That's bounced.
All right.
Yeah, exactly.
So we're going to get rid of class 3. So class 4 is the new class 3, and so that would change the minimum lot size, no class 1 or class 2 land use regulated by this ordinance shall be situated on a tract of land less than 10 acres, and class 4, 3 land uses shall be located on a tract no less than 40 acres in size.
And talking about waste facilities, we do have a waste facility expert with us this morning.
Well, Mike, Clyde and I were just talking. The concern is, I think you put a 150-foot buffer on that. Did I hear it right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you start talking to EPA and the state DEQ, they're going to demand certain buffers for your water wells, yeah, and gas wells.
So these wouldn't really affect the waste. They really wouldn't affect because the state's going to take over and make
it
more stringent.
Well, the state's going to mandate that there be a certain amount of buffer between your property line and when you're actually putting in inert waste.
Because so if we put 150 and they come up and said 200, that's up to them.
That would be correct.
The problem, remember, is that inert debris is not lined.
Right. Well, that is true.
Say that again, Clyde.
It's not lined.
The facility doesn't have a line.
But under the new provisions, any new construction would be lined. So assuming it's new construction, it would have to be lined, and that pushes your...
And the state tells you a lot about what you did.
Absolutely.
I had a conversation this morning. If we look at a 40-acre minimum requirement on class 4 and a 1,200-foot and a 500-foot setback and a 1,200-foot offset, I was told that looks like about 120-acre minimum property requirement. But that's up.
And that's probably true, though. I mean, that's if you take a map and draw it up,
sounds like what it needs to be to me.
I think it needs to be there.
Yeah, keep in mind, these are the most impactful uses.
Yeah, right.
And so,
yeah.
And that's what you're protecting your neighbors.
Right, exactly.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you just let me know.
We appreciate it. Sure do.
Great. All right, then, land use spacing and protected facilities. I didn't make any changes on page 9 to what they had done. Okay, page 10, groundwater well study. So, I thought about this a lot, and I think that I am the commissioner who lives in the most rural setting. I live on 45 acres in the northern part of the county, and I try to put myself in the position of the people in Snow Camp and think about, if I were, you know, in a community being affected by this, what would be the most important thing to me? And clean water and knowing my well's not going to go dry would be the most important thing to me. So I added a requirement for a groundwater well study to the ordinance. And I'll read it for those who do not have it in front of them. It would be all Class 3 industries now. All Class 3 industries regulated by this ordinance shall provide a study that details how much water is anticipated to be consumed by the industry's activity, what amount of groundwater is safe and sustainable in the immediate vicinity of the use, and whether wells within 2,000 feet, and I just threw that in as like a discussion point, 2,000 feet of the industry's property line will be affected by such withdrawals. Said study must be performed by a qualified professional at the permit applicant's expense. A study undertaken pursuant to state or federal regulations or for purposes of applying for a state permit may be deemed acceptable in the planning director's discretion. And so it's important, though, that the public remember that this is still a checklist. And a company who's coming in applying for a permit, and they get the study, and their study says all the wells in the area are going to run dry, that doesn't mean we can deny them the permit. They would still get the permit because they met the qualifications of the checklist. Is that right, Mr. Albright?
Yes, that's correct.
So part of the hesitation is building an expectation that something would be done as a result of the study. So why support having it? I support having it because at least it gives the people in the community a baseline to know what is going to happen. And if your wells do run dry and you've got a study that's been done showing that the company knew your well was going to run dry, then at least you have some evidence that you can use in a private suit to get compensation from the company for the damage that they've done to your property.
Is that acceptable?
It doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it's
but
not.
Whatever.
Well, let's talk about that with Mr. Albright.
That
makes no sense at all.
Because we're...
That sounds like we've said they can do it, even though we know that if they do it, it's going to screw our citizens. So that doesn't make a problem for us.
We ought to be able to tell them who they got to use.
That's right. Exactly right.
I mean, my gosh.
Yeah, we don't want that to happen.
So is what you're asking if the board would have the permission, the ability to deny a permit if a groundwater study showed that it was going to deplete all wells in the area?
I think if that's going to happen, we need the power to delete that from happening.
I don't know the answer to that question,
yeah,
but that sounds like...
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at, Mr. Albright.
Let us take us to court.
That involves a set of expertise that I'm not qualified to comment on. Groundwater levels and what depletes them and the aquifers, which way they flow. When I was a corporate lawyer many, many years ago, we ran into these issues with pollution. I worked for a textile company, and there were chromium levels of water that were discovered. Print plant had been there 150 years. And we had experts come in and tell us how much groundwater there was and which way it went. So I don't know how you can predict that. I mean, if somebody puts in 500 homes next to your home and your well goes dry, I mean, that's a pretty good indication that they've depleted the groundwater. But I don't know any other way to do it, or predict it with any degree of certainty.
So, Mr. Albright, you're saying that if we get a study that shows if the planning department and the planning board are reviewing an application and it has a study that shows we're going to dry up all your wells within 2,000 feet of this operation, nobody can say no just because they provided a study. Because that, to me, that doesn't make any sense.
Why can't you say if you don't meet these guidelines in a satisfactory manner that
you don't get a permit
that addresses the quality of life of this county?
That should say that this study will provide that you will not drain the well.
I agree with that. If you do, then you're going to pay.
So what you'd be saying is you would want the ordinance to read that the board the permit would not be approved unless the study demonstrated that wells would be okay. Everybody's wells around the development would be all right.
You can't guarantee that. I've had a real live experience with this. We were building one house here and one house here. I had a well drill drilling for me, and this guy's well went dry temporarily. And this well driller, what he said is the truth. What's under your property is yours. What's under this other guy's is his.
Now, when you drilled his well deeper, his water went to yours.
It went, but it came back. Okay. So, that, you know, if we're in a dry spell, does that mean that this company can't get a permit if they did a study in the middle of summer when we're in a dry spell? Because rivers under the ground are running at all times. And sometimes we do run into that. We have dry wells popping up throughout the county now. I mean, that's just, I don't know where you go with that.
It would only apply to the class three uses, is that correct? And I'm not sure how many of those are really big water users, so it may be that there's not very many. This would not happen very often, but.
To me, it doesn't make sense to say we're going to issue a permit to somebody who says we're going to drop everybody's well.
I agree.
Right.
Sure. I think everybody can do it.
Well, there's also
we don't want them. They don't do that. We don't want them. In my opinion, we don't want them coming.
Well, there's issue of the width. So I just put in 2,000 feet. That doesn't really have any rhyme or reason for me putting in there. But so if you live, you know,
2,200 feet,
and your well goes dry, you know, where is that boundary, and how far is 2,000 feet from the property line? That's further than the land, the spacing requirement. So is that fair? Should it be 1,200 feet instead of 2,000? Should it be 300 feet, the length of a football field? And should it be everybody within that boundary or a percentage?
Can we check to see if anybody else has an ordinance statement similar to this? And if so, what their requisite requirements are?
I think that other places have a zoning.
We can check. I'm not familiar with anything like that. Unless you go out west, they have water rights and a whole corridor of water rights.
Yeah, that's a whole different animal. Western water rights.
I just don't know how you predict it. I mean, somebody builds 500 homes next to your house, can't expect. No. Your well might be a little lower. But you're in the same aquifer. It's like a giant lake.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And you know what happened to Lake Tahoe? It dried. All the water got sucked out. And they're still building houses in California. Of course, they're burning down, but they'll build about
next
year.
Not enough water to put them out, right?
Yeah. But I mean, that's something that I just don't know how you predict that. Any degree of certainty. I'm not familiar with any engineering company do it, but I certainly look.
So I don't know what you gentlemen want to do about the proposal to include that in this ordinance. The reason I put in there that the last sentence, the study undertaken pursuant to state or federal regulations or for purposes of applying for a state permit may be deemed acceptable in the planning director's discretion, just because if they have to do a water study for the state, then they can use the same one and not have to redo and resubmit or pay for a second study. There's also, you know, Mr. Carter, you were talking about your concerns about being too business unfriendly.
I know.
I mean, this is one of those individual property rights versus attracting business kind of things.
It is.
It's difficult. I mean, I don't want my well to be messed up either. I certainly do not.
No. We've had to redo a well one time, so I mean, what that's like. So. And you're right. One new well and another lot can go ahead and have to change your depth of the existing well.
Or you just stay down deeper and get lower knee loose.
Mm-hmm. And we are, I think, what Mr. Albright maybe was saying about the subdivision going next door can deplete your well, and that's not at all addressed in the subdivision ordinance or anywhere else in our county ordinances.
I don't think it is. I mean, from personal experience, I had a neighbor sell her farm, or her son sold her, that she passed away, and there were 500 homes out there, and all over well. And I had to have some work on my well this spring. It happened.
So I wish, you know, in support of what I've drafted here, I would say that it's better to know what the impact is than not know. And if they have to submit it for the state, then they can be made to submit the same thing to the county, too.
Mr. Vines indicated he wanted to ask a question.
Well, I wanted to make a suggestion. As I've been down to Florida and they deal with this issue of water use, what you might consider is they allow a well to be dug, and the usage of that well, would it be 30 gallons per hour or whatever it is, that's what that well can be used on. Once that well reaches that point for a day or whatever you want to set it on, then no more water can be pumped out of that well. They have a water usage set on that well.
On their wells.
Right, and you have to get the permit and get it issued as to how many gallons of water you're going to use in your facility
a
day.
That's a great idea. That's a great idea.
And it comes out, then that's it. Once that amount is used, it shuts down. For what it's a year's time or month's time or whatever. And
is that residential and business?
That's business, and in the agriculture as well. There's greenhouses or whatever. You can only use so much water for that permit, and you cannot get that permit issued unless it meets all the conservation measures, as drip irrigations or whatever. And it has to meet all those criteria, and you cannot use no more than that gallons, which I guess protects the people downstream. But I mean, that's just, I mean,
I don't know who pays for those meters. And I think that a lot of people in Alamance County, if we slap them with a meter fee.
What I'm talking about in this, this ordinance that you're talking about, if you're going to issue a permit and they're going to use a certain amount of water, that you could require them not to get a permit for the well, and that the meter's put on there and it's governed by the county.
But isn't that dependent on the well itself? I mean, it's not like when you're drafting something like this, correct me if I'm wrong, it's better if you have standards that are uniformly applicable, that everybody's treated the same. But a well in Snow Camp might be different from one in Ospee or Pleasant Grove or something like that.
You have to come up with what kind of usage that you want to allow on water.
Off of that well.
Yeah.
That's right, off of that well.
Whatever usage it is.
I think that is really outside the scope of what we're able to do today for in county government with our staff. Yeah, ma'am. So. Going back to the
question then becomes to how do we manage that?
Yeah. How does that get reported? How does it get monitored?
Well, the textile business, back when we had a textile business, they monitored their intake and their water that went into the grand plant up here, all river. Mm-hmm. 2-3 million gallons a day.
Right.
Clean before it went in, because when Burlington died, something yellow, the river was yellow. We cleaned it, we used it, we cleaned it, put it back in. But with a facility that uses that volume, you have to have a river. You couldn't run something like that on a well.
Mr. Albright, if we were to try to, if we had a, in the land use plan that's being come up with for Snow Camp, through land use regulation, is there a way that the well issue can be addressed through that kind of thing? You've often said that through zoning that that would be a better way to determine where the businesses are located, things right. like that. Is this another example of an advantage that we would have through that kind of regulation?
I know Orange County has an ordinance in, the, in their zoning ordinance on water usage. You have to predict what type of usage, and if you damage, I think it involves industry, if you damage someone's well, it's covered in their zoning ordinance.
That's what I'm thinking about. That's
in fact, I just have to have a copy of it. Sent by one of the Snow Camp mine folks this morning. One of those attachments you wouldn't open up.
Yeah, we opened it. Y'all
brave. I foolishly opened it.
Y'all brave.
Everything's going to crash now, but anyway. They have what they call a no-fault well repair fund as part of their zoning ordinance.
Who's that?
Orange County.
Orange County. County.
And their well, the health department administers environmental health. And Martin Marietta provided for it in 2002.
So it requires that the company, if it damages somebody's well, pays for the cost to re-drill a new well?
It says that it was established in 2002, I don't have my glasses on this fine print, but anyway, as a condition of a special use permit for continued quarry activities, apparently they expanded the quarry. And they said that as a condition of that, the company would create this fund that would address well failures.
It's like a contingency type fund.
Right. They have a determination procedure. The homeowner calls the county and says, hey, my well went dry. The health department goes out. They check for bacteriological, inorganic, chemical contamination. They check the quantity of water, and then they have a repair, treatment, renovation, replacement. All kinds of details as part of their special use permit process. So that may be the best way to address this type of concern.
So would that go in the ordinance, this ordinance, or would that go in?
Well, I'm talking about doing something we can put in our zoning ordinance. If you don't want to address it today. That's the bottom line.
What's that going to do with the, what's down there now? That'll cover that too, won't it?
Well, they've already, we don't have zoning. We didn't give them a special use permit.
Right.
But in the future, when we have zoning.
You have to have zoning to have
then
that
have to
operation
have
go in effect with special use.
The reason they put this in there, apparently, they expanded their quarry in 2002. And as part of that expansion, Orange County said, okay, if you're going to expand it, then you're going to address any well issues.
Uh-huh. All right, I stuck my neck out there. I drafted
pretty,
something
pretty
to start
subject,
with.
Right?
Well, I think you've done a good job.
I'm waiting to hear somebody say how we should change what I drafted.
Oh, Lord.
That's my line.
What was your line?
He said that was a
pretty deep
subject
you got into.
Yuck,
pretty shallow.
Okay.
Humor there.
Yes.
Anyway.
It sounds like with the revisions you've proposed, we need to, I don't know, I mean, I know we are running out of time on our moratorium.
What is that?
December, so we only have one more meeting.
After this one.
After this one. I would suggest that we actually write up what we've come up with today, because we've covered a pretty long trail here in the last hour and a half or whatever.
There is an old saying that the perfect is the enemy of the good.
Exactly. But the understandable is also needed too, because we've talked a lot about a lot of things, and I want to make sure that I understand what's going in and what's coming out.
Better have something than nothing. How open-ended can this be? In other words, can it be amended 2 months from now?
You can amend it anytime you wish.
Right, okay.
After a public hearing.
This ain't about as piecemeal as I've ever seen in my life. And, mm-hmm. But it's better to have something than nothing. And right now we don't have anything. Work 2 cents anyway. This might be worth three.
Are y'all happy with the 2,000 feet, or would you rather go to the 1,200 feet and with the land use spacing, or you want to make it 2,500 feet, or a mile?
A couple of miles.
Well, we really don't know.
Have problems, right?
We really don't know.
You don't have any expertise in well evaluation, and we're just kind of picking a number out of there.
And as Clyde said, that Orange County ordinance basically was built around zoning and the special use permit. I don't know where we go with that.
Let me ask you a question. How do we get 2 acres per lot in a flood? Okay, timber. Okay. How do we get 2 acres? We always fall back on this no countywide zoning. We got that.
That's state.
I'm sorry?
That's state mandated. State signs that for us.
Yeah. State controls so much of what we do here, basically.
Yeah, perhaps you could say if any class 1, 2, or 3, or just limited to class 3, proposed industry, is going to be required by the state to do a groundwater study, that groundwater study would need to be done before the county permit was. So even if you're not doing anything with it, you can't say no. You will at least, the company's going to have to do it anyway for the state, but you'll get it on the front end. Everybody that comes to the planning board meeting when it's being discussed will be able to see it and know what's coming and talk about it then. So you're not putting any thing on it that says we won't let it come. It's just if you have to do it for the state, for your industry, you'll do it for our permit process, submit it with your permit, and then we just all get to see it.
And it's not an added cost to the industry looking to locate it.
And if you want to research it later and amend the ordinance to do something about the data, that might be something that could be done later on. But at the least, you would see what the state will see before the county issues the permit.
So maybe what you're saying is, for the last sentence, we would say, if a study is undertaken pursuant to state or federal regulation or for purposes of applying for a state permit, said study must be submitted.
I would say as part of the county's permit process.
It's the application, yeah. Basically.
How would you phrase that, Mr. Albright?
Well, right at the end of planning director's discretion, I had a sentence that the study must be submitted as part of the application process.
Study should be
permitted.
And would you want to make that for all classes or just for class 4? If a class 1, I don't know if a class 1 requires
it. If it's required by the state, I think that will mandate they're going to have to do it.
For the county level, right. Even if it's a class 1. If one of the class 1 uses requires a state groundwater study to get a permit, then we want to see it before we get a permit.
Class 1s that don't require any type of disturbance or anything with wells and stuff. Water.
That way, if any of the industries listed here in any class have to give a groundwater study to the state to get some kind of permit from the state, they'll have to give it to the county to get a permit from the county.
I think that's a great idea.
Because it's going to be disruptive to the groundwater supply, and you got it up front.
But is it at their discretion or our discretion?
I don't think there would be anything. The county, again, this kind of goes back to what we talked about. The county wouldn't be able to do anything about it, but it's going on to the state at the very least. You would see it. Public would know it. Everybody could come to the planning board meeting and to the commissioners if the commissioners retain the final approval and talk about it and all those things. But the state, at least we would see the same data as a state, but we would see it before the state gets it.
And possibly we would not have a different map of what are streams and what are not.
Right.
Yes. What we they showed.
Yes.
So we would delete the first couple of sentences, not have a vicinity requirement, and it would read something like, if a study is undertaken pursuant to state or federal regulations, or for purposes of applying for a state permit, then said study must be submitted before the plan...
submitted as part of the application.
As part
of the application.
Must be submitted as part...
part of the application, but how that way we would have it from the get-go.
Okay. Great. All right, I didn't make any changes to the operations area. Landscaping and screening, I put back in the class four uses, so we can delete those now on page 11. And if y'all need a recess,
I've got a doctor's appointment at lunch, so as long as I get here about 1:45, I'll be all right.
Good luck with that.
Well, I'm going.
You got to get.
Whether we do or not.
What's more important?
I might die tomorrow. So,
yeah. All right, then. Grandfathering non-conforming uses, there's no changes. Permitting procedures, I didn't change. Page 13. Page 14, I added, at our last meeting, we talked about that adjacent property owners should get a notice of a public hearing by certified mail. And so I simply added that. The applicant shall cause to be mailed a notice of the public hearing by certified mail to the last at the last address listed on county tax abstracts for the owners of all parcels of land abutting that parcel of land as shown in the county tax listing and provide proof of mailing to the planning director. So that's all I added there. We already talked about that. So okay, so page 15, here's something to discuss. So this is how the application is approved. I think you all remember that the planning board approved draft had the planning director saying that the application was complete and then submitting it to the planning board for approval or for a recommendation of whether it should be approved or not approved and then coming to the commissioners for a final decision. So my draft says that upon submission of the site plan and all accompanying documents, the applicant shall certify the application package is complete and ready for public hearing. I think under the planning board draft, it was the planning director who determines that the application is complete. I think the applicant should certify that the package is complete and ready for public hearing. Then the planning department shall review the site plan based on compliance with the regulations imposed by this ordinance and make a recommendation of approval or denial. I think that our planning director, my opinion is that our planning director should make a recommendation about whether the permit should be approved or denied. I would like to hear that from our planning director since they are the staff person with expertise in these matters. After holding the required public hearing, the planning board shall review the application package and the planning director's recommendation. If the planning board determines that the application is compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, the planning board shall instruct the planning director to issue the intent to construct permit. If the planning board determines that the application is not compliant with the requirements of this ordinance, the planning board shall issue a written determination of its reasons and deny the application. And then in the appeal of a denied application, if the planning board, the planning director and the planning board don't agree, then the matter comes to the Board of Commissioners.
I still think final approval ought to come from this.
I think so too.
I don't think there are enough of these that have come through over the last 10 years to justify planning board having a final say-so, and we get sideswiped because we didn't understand what went on at the planning board 1 week.
Or the director's office.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my response in part to that is that we don't have any control. There are a couple of things. One is that we don't have any control over whether these items come up during the course of the year. And so in April, May, and June, this board is really consumed by the budget. We have a budget presentation by county government, a budget presentation by ABSS, a budget presentation by ACC that are all lengthy and take up a lot of time. Then we have a budget public hearing in May, and we have a vote in June. And if we have one of these issues come up during that three-month time, I mean, we're at 12 o'clock now. We have two items on for a closed session that I don't think we're going to get to today. We're going to postpone those probably, and they were postponed or tabled, and they were tabled from the last time. We had another time in the last year and a half, where we had items which had to be tabled because we had essentially ran out of time.
We did.
And we also have issues come up from time to time in county government that are not directly related to the day-to-day working of the government, such as, you know, the ICE contract took up a lot of time, the Mountain Valley Pipeline took up a lot of time. We have other things that come up, and I think that my personal opinion is that it's important to preserve margin in the space of the commissioner meeting time so that we can be able to take care of the business that has to be, I mean, absolutely has to be done. We have to pass a budget. And 3 months out of the year is a quarter of the year. We don't have any control over when that's going to, you know, when these issues are going to arise. And it's not because, you know, I'm insensitive to the people from Snow Camp or any other part of the community who's concerned about these things being in their backyard, but I just think it's really important to me that we make sure that the essential functions, the contracts get approved, the budget amendments get done, that when we have a department head who needs the board to act on something, that there's that time available. Well, that's just my opinion.
I'm going to have to disagree with you. Number one, we've spent a long time discussing something because we didn't have a check safe in place. We've had a lot of people up here, I'm not upset about them voicing their, you know, opinions. We could have reviewed probably 4 PIDO applications in the time we did, and I was on the board when we wrote the last one. And we made a mistake there by not having that check safe in there. Cities do it. Every meeting they'll have something on their agendas to review in zoning. And
that's all cities do is zoning.
And it comes to us. 90% it comes to them from the planning board, just like we have a planning board. Yeah. And this particular HIDO issue doesn't come up often. And the second question I have to ask about this, we've had a moratorium for how long?
Since February.
We pretty much shut down any business from coming into our county since February that may fall in this, you know, classification. Mm-hmm. So my question is, we've spent a whole lot of time talking about a mistake we made. And if I'm here, I don't want to spend next year talking about the mistake that got made right after the moratorium went off. I'd like to see it come to the board for final approval on a HIDO. That's, you know.
What if we required these sorts of approval items that come before us to come before us at a nighttime meeting?
I mean, well, you'd be here all night.
Late, but we could be.
You would be here all night.
But we wouldn't be tying people up in a public hearing during the work schedule. I mean, just a thought, just another way to look at it.
What if we said that we're going to do it for class 4? Or class, the new
class
3?
I don't think you can discriminate on that. If it falls within this ordinance that we're writing, which is not a zoning, it acts like it's a zoning, but it's not really zoning. It's
about as close as you can be.
It's about as close as you can get to it, but it's not really zoning. We're not separating that.
Mr. Albright, do you think that would be a legal thing to distinguish the class 3 uses and say that if a class 3 permit gets to come to the Board of Commissioners? but not the ones and twos?
Well, it's all a matter of degree, but as Mr. Boswell said, we spent the last year working on this issue. And if this board had approved the quarry, and had been presented with a quarry permit, we might not have done all that.
Yeah, but that doesn't answer my question. Would it be legal, or would it be acceptable drafting to sort out the Class 3 uses and have them come to the Board of Commissioners for final approval and not the ones and the twos?
Well, you make that distinction. I think it would be better to have them all or nothing. I really do.
Why?
It's just consistency.
Yes.
And when people come to the county and they want to develop a business, they know what they're up against.
Well, that's a policy opinion, right? Not a legal opinion. So it would be legal to sort the ones and twos separate from the threes.
You can divide it up, sure, but I just think it causes more confusion than anything else.
I don't see how it causes any more confusion than having the different land spacing. They all get treated differently in a lot of different ways. But somebody else talk.
I agree with you. I think at least number four, category four.
We don't have four.
We make that decision.
We don't have that.
Three.
Three.
That's a lot
yes.
of moving
yeah.
parts.
Yes.
That'll eliminate a lot of minor things.
And one thing you could think of too, Commissioners, is under this new arrangement, you'll know about all of them. You know, we have a system in place for our central permitting now. So if a Class 1 comes in, you'll know about it as soon as it is applied for. So you'll have the opportunity to ask any questions of planning staff or county staff. So you'll always know about it. And if you wanted to attend the planning board meeting where a 1 or a 2 was considered, you could certainly do that. So it's not like it would happen as this last one did, where the commissioners would not even know that it had been applied for. So
I'm still a firm believer that commissioners need a final say-so on it. And I think all classes need to be put in there. If you're going to do it, just do it.
Well, if I may add, Commissioner Bond, if you are doing zoning and you're going to have zoning, that's what you're going to be doing.
You're going to approve recommendation by the planning board. If there's not been a discussion from the community about it at all, it's going to be on our commissioner list. Today we're having a zoning on a quarry in Snow Camp. And if you see that as a citizen of Snow Camp and you got concern and planning board passed it because they met every check mark, you can still come and petition your commissioners as to why you don't think it should be passed. And I think that's what the citizens of the county deserve, is that option, because we are elected. And thank you guys on the planning board, but they're volunteers. They only have so much time. It took them a long time to all get in one group to make a plan.
Well, why don't we just get rid of the planning board then and have them all come to the commissioners?
Because they've got to vet through the process. And once they've vetted, and they may turn it down on the planning board side, which the city does that a lot of time, and bring a recommendation from planning board to deny permit.
That's right.
And then
that's exactly how they
the
do.
Commission, the council goes over them.
That's
so,
right.
I mean, it's still that it's a work in process. And we don't, you talk about time, you want to get down in the weeds with the planning, the planning director to work through each individual situation, you can spend a lot of time.
That's why I'm not on the city council.
But we're not going to have, I would grant you it's not that
many. You can deck a whole day or a week on things that I really didn't care about.
Well, we spent a lot on this issue.
Bad news.
But anyhow, that's my thoughts on it. Y'all can do with it what you want.
What's your thoughts, Tim?
What's our options? Let's
the options
let's
are,
take one road or the other.
Options are, but the way you hear everything in then a category three,
yeah,
and nothing in one and two.
Unless the planning board and the planning director disagree.
If they disagree,
like if she says or he says approve it, and the planning board says no, don't approve it, even if it's a one, it would still come to the commissioners. If there's
I think that's enough.
So would there
oversight.
Not be an appeal process though for the applicant?
Yeah,
it's an oversight. Yeah.
It's still, that would still
get to appeal.
Checks and balances.
Yeah, checks and balances.
Let's do it.
The question, though, is do all classes come for approval? All of these different industries, when they take it to Tanya, she says, okay, you've checked everything off, and then it just goes through. We don't hear about it, really.
Don't we?
That's the problem.
I know. Right? Aren't we going to be provided a list of...
Yes, we've got the permit software set up now. As soon as Tanya enters a permit into central permitting, all county staff, county attorney, myself, I don't even remember who all gets an email immediately that says a permit's been applied for a solar farm, which we would then share with the commissioners. We can put the commissioners on that. We've not, since folks come and go sometimes. So it's just been all county administration. I think we've even included the school superintendent and anybody else out there that could possibly be touched by a
like subdivision or something
yes.
of that nature.
So, but it's only limited to this order, these HIDO permit applications. That's right. Okay.
I just don't see how we can deny a right of appeal to a class one and two, but allow it to.
That's not a denial. If you don't get the planning board. And time you make that decision, if one or the other doesn't make it, it comes to us.
Well, they all
they made a decision, they denied it.
Yes, if one denies it, then it's automatically comes to us.
But if they both deny it, the applicant still doesn't have
it. It still passes.
But in under a zoning scenario, they can be denied and it still comes to the council,
mm-hmm.
city council.
Mr. Carter, Commissioner Carter, one thing to remember, if we are rocketing towards zoning, I don't know where we are in that process, but looking down the road, it's better to have a HIDO that fits into that
right.
pattern of review.
So what are you suggesting?
I would suggest that you have all of them.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah.
That's what I was saying.
I would agree with you. That's a good way to do it.
Going back to page 15, appeal of a denied application. Within 30 days of the issuance of a written determination by the planning board, the applicant or planning director may appeal the decision of the planning board to the Board of Commissioners, who shall review the written determination of the planning board and review the application for compliance with the requirements of this ordinance. And so the applicant, if they disagree with the decision of the planning board, presumably because it's been denied, they still get to come to the Board of Commissioners. So the only people who would not come to the Board of Commissioners are the class one and class twos who the planning director and the planning board have agreed meet the requirements of the permit.
Well, I support our county attorney's opinion on this. And
Commissioner Carter.
And that's the same as Mr. Boswell.
That was my
primarily Eddie. Kind of
okay. Then we will go with the planning board approved version of that approval of intent to construct permit applications. That would be
okay.
Article 4, Section 4, Number 3, page 1415. That would be the planning board version to be approved.
Yes.
Okay. That settles that.
All right.
What's the planning board version again?
What?
Was the planning board version that the commission
they were recommending to send it to the commission?
Everything comes here, no matter what. So there's no other draft changes in there. No other changes. Okay, now on page 19, Article 7, spacing waivers and variances. There's some blue text there because I was a little confused in looking at the different drafts of the HIDO. Article 7, waiver of land use spacing requirements. So the one that I had that I had marked as being from the planning board approved was different from this, and I didn't know if this is something that came in later. So this is the waiver of land use spacing requirement. The waiver may be granted with those two standards added.
Those were added in a final review between staff, legal, everything. To pursue the quasi-judicial hearing that this requires, it needed some guts to it, and we pulled that kind of from existing ordinances around us and kind of state law to give guidance on how you would do the waiver.
That's what I thought.
Yes.
And so that was not included, though, in the planning board approved version. Is that right?
Right, that was afterwards. That was after y'all's discussion of how to. We found some language to put it in.
Okay. That's what I thought. I just thought I'd draw attention to that since it was a change from what the planning board had done. Okay. Does anybody have any questions about that? And then I think that that is all of the changes that have come to my attention.
Without reviewing this, going back through it, did we address these issues that were presented to today's meeting?
No, we have not gotten to that yet.
That's what I thought.
Put too much on the agenda.
This is the only thing on it.
That's all we've gotten to, anyhow, right?
Good halves. Let me ask you a quick question. How many cubic yards of stone do we think is going to come out of this quarry? Any idea? Have we even asked?
I've asked.
What's the answer?
He says $85 million worth. I don't know how that
$85 million
calculates. I asked him that question at the get-go.
But they can't give us a quantitative.
It depends the price per yard when you crush it and haul it.
I don't want to belabor it. I've sent it to Mr. Poe. I've sent it to Mr. Ulicki. But this is unreal. I mean, it's not just happening here, but there's a county in Washington State, Skagit County, 2,000 square miles, 115,000 population. Five times our size. March of this year, strong opposition rising against Marble Mound Quarry project application. But just listen to these numbers here. If you don't mind, let me just read this, if you don't mind. Now, let's scroll down. Okay. Okay, here we go. The company is seeking permission to remove about 3.8 million cubic yards of stone. It's a 29-acre site going to 80, relatively same size, right? Close? No, it's small. Smaller? According to the application traffic study, the project anticipates 260 daily trips, split 130 in, 130 out, with 100 truck trips related to whatever. I mean, it's amazing. You should see what's online about what they're doing. And I don't know.
That's in their application.
Yeah, well, it's the county's reply to the whole thing. I mean, it's just unbelievable. And I did send it to you, and I sent you, what's the name?
Ulicki.
I'm terrible at names. And I think it'd be apropos to give them a phone call and just see if they can help us. Because we definitely need some help. But anyway, I'm sorry. That's just a stunning.
I think that's important.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm waiting for somebody to say something.
I don't need to do 5 minute recess.
Would you like to take a recess? Mr. Sutton needs to leave. And
with no disrespect, I have got to be somewhere at 1. I can stay here at quarter till. That's 30 minutes.
I don't think anybody's ready to make a motion. I want to make sure everybody understands that if somebody makes a motion on the ordinance as amended today and includes that statement of continuity or whatever set up with it, and we don't have a 5-0 vote, then we have to vote again at the next meeting. And if it's not a unanimous vote at that meeting, it's fine. But if we put it off today and then have not a 5-0 vote at the next meeting, then we would be voting at the first meeting in December and the moratorium would have expired. And then people would be applying on December 3rd, 4th, under the 2011 ordinance. to be grandfathered.
If it's open-ended, I'll vote.
Yeah, I would like to see it, but I'm okay today to vote with
I am too.
What
okay.
we've added to it today. Yeah. I know Clyde's got to sit down and
when we
cipher through what we've yeah. talked about, but we have talked about a lot of things.
Kind of like vote on it and then circulate a draft for yes. post vote for signatures.
I would be okay to do that.
Hey, pardon?
It's like circulate a draft for signatures after the vote today.
I think it would be good for us to go ahead and vote on it today. And I don't know if everybody's in agreement, but to me, I'm okay with the recommended changes that were made in our meeting, and I will make a motion to that effect. I don't think we can cover all of that, Steve, and a lot of that is going to be covered by the state anyhow. Well, I don't know where we put that in our what we've got written.
Yeah.
I don't know.
We can only do what the state allows us
right.
to do. And they
just like utility easements, we have no say so on where they run utility easements. So, in retrospect, where do you have say so over what happens with that utility easement? You may not have any say so over, but that's part of the state preview to look at that part of it. I don't know.
Well, a quick question, Mr. Albright. Can we, are these items that we can't address in our ordinance?
All the five that were brought forward today.
He didn't get a copy of that.
You don't yes. have a copy of this?
Yeah, I got.
I think I sent you one.
Yes, I got the copy of the email, and I haven't studied them, but I think a lot of them have already been covered.
Yeah, we're already talking about.
Well, that's what I was asking. Have we already yes. hit these?
We've covered most of them, but there's
yeah,
a few.
I thought we covered them.
Sediment erosion. The state will actually. If they've got to do drainage stuff, they've got to follow state guidelines on that, Jordan Lake rules. And I don't know, our ordinances are written off of state ordinance, basically, when we did the Jordan Lake
rules. The solar farm issue with the sediment runoff says it wasn't addressed. So.
Well,
okay.
I think Raleigh. Yeah,
that's coming up for review, and it needs to be reviewed. Is that correct?
What, Jordan Lake?
No, the solar.
Yeah, let's get into that.
The runoff with the
draft is everybody.
Yeah.
Right. I haven't had
solar
chance
farm.
To look that up.
With the solar farm.
Right. I haven't had a chance to look that up. We're going to be on site Wednesday with the solar farm.
Okay.
Doing planning and everything out there this week.
Okay. I'll second your motion.
What was the motion?
The motion was that we take the amendments that we have made to what we brought in here today. Amy, a lot of her suggestions we've all agreed upon, I think. Other than the coming back to commissioners, I think that was the biggest sticking point in that. I would suggest that we go ahead and vote on what we've got today and make sure Clyde can put it into words so we can all look at it. And then, Amy, boss lady said, okay, the Board of Commissioners hereby find that the proposed amendments to the Alamance County Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance are consistent with Alamance County Land Development Plan as adopted to promote flexibility in development ordinances to develop conscious strategies for proactively managing the type of growth that is consistent with the county's overall vision and goals, and therefore today after we vote on that, that will be part of it, but we will review it in our next setting to make sure that what we thought we heard today is in the final draft.
Right.
I mean, is that okay as a, because we really don't have a final draft to vote on.
Well, it's all been recorded.
So if okay. we approve this motion today, then if we make an amendment to the documents between now and the next meeting, do we not have to have two votes then?
You can vote on it again at that meeting.
We can vote
just
on
one time?
Yes.
One time will be sufficient to
yes.
pass.
If you get five votes, five affirmative.
Provided
even with
unanimous.
Changes between now and then. If there are changes between now and then.
That's, I understand the motion. It's to redraft the ordinance with all the changes you've discussed today, bring it back to the next meeting where you'll look at it and vote on it. Is that the motion?
That is exactly what I said.
But my question is, if we make changes between what we approved today, Amy was talking about two votes, same motion. Am I right?
That's
two
correct.
Votes, same vote, 2-5-0 votes, same motion. Then if we make a change between today and the next meeting, is that a two votes on the same motion?
No.
Or the same ordinance, no. And we'd have to do it twice then.
We're going to have to vote today to accept what we discuss as part of the record. And I guess at any point after, you can come back and amend this ordinance if you don't really like the way it ended up. It can be readdressed.
But you've got the big, ugly green monster known as the moratorium.
Yeah, that's right.
I was asking the question. Basically, we aren't making any changes between now and our December meeting.
No. Actually, the end of December.
Or the end of November meeting,
yes. Yeah.
The 18th.
Okay. Are you saying you can't amend it after the moratorium?
Well, no.
We can pass it as we've talked about.
Put that bold
today. I'll second your motion.
Please.
We got 3 votes already.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the amended heavy industrial development ordinance as amended today per discussion, plus the consistency statement. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. So let's take a recess, and then we have a little bit more work to do.
What is a
request for approval to apply for a grant from the health department. Stacy Saunders, our health director, is here. Hello.
How you doing?
Doing well.
Good.
I know you all are tired, so I'm hoping that this will be very easy. So what you have before you is a request to apply and seeks approval to apply, and if awarded, budget up to $5,000 in grant funding from Delta Dental, which is a foundation that we have received funds from for about 5 years now. And typically we apply and use these funds for different types of equipment, because dental equipment can be very expensive. And so there is no required match for these. There's no out-of-state travel associated with this grant. And that's what you have for me.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that grant application. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
And we have Foxy Harper here to talk to us about the volunteer shortage with the adult care home CAC. And Ms. Harper has waited and waited and waited for her turn.
We're aging in place up here.
So thank you for your patience.
After all, I am retired.
That's true.
That's what you had in mind for your retirement.
Thank you.
And I know that you all have been interested in seniors in the past, and I'm going to count on that again. After all, some of you are one. I had to face that one day when I was working in the Area Agency on Aging before I retired, and I was one of the people that I could be serving. Thank you for allowing me to talk to you after a very wearisome morning. And I want to talk to you about our Community Advisory Committee, and I really should say committees for Alamance County. And the plural is because the Alamance County committees are actually two, the Nursing Home Committee and the Adult Care Home Committee. And so I am going to be using the term CAC to represent Community Advisory Committee instead of saying that over and over, if you don't mind. And I'd like to acknowledge our lead ombudsman, Kim Johnson, who's back here waiting with me. And she provides training and support to both of our CACs in Alamance County. As you know, you appoint the county volunteers who comprise the CACs. the Long-Term Care Ombudsman Program of the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, better known as PTRC, and the Area Agency on Aging, oversees the work that we volunteers do. There's a lot of work for us to do in Alamance County. There are 8 nursing homes with a total of 980 beds. There are 17 adult care homes with 658 spaces for residents. And there are 39 family care homes with spaces for 222 residents. This is one of the highest populations per county in the state, and it requires a lot of work on our part. As the chairperson for the Adult Care CAC, I'd like to tell you what we do and the dilemma that we face. Our CAC visits the adult care and family care homes to be advocates for the rights of the residents, which were established by the state legislature. We visit each of the adult care homes quarterly and the family care homes at least once a year. As a byline, that isn't enough, but that's what's required. We talk to the residents about how they like their home, if their rights to privacy, to be treated with respect and dignity, and to be treated as individuals are being respected. We interact with families when there are family members present, with staff and administrators, and report about our visits to our ombudsman. On occasion, we encounter something that needs their immediate attention and intervention, and so we then advise the ombudsman of our concern so that they can follow up with that issue that we've uncovered. The people who reside in these homes are vulnerable ages, adults, due to age, physical, and or mental disabilities over the age of 18, who can no longer live in their homes. A significant portion of the residents lack support from family or friends, which means they have no one to advocate for them, and we can and do fill that role. The requirements for making our official visits are that we must have at least 2 community advisory committee members present. To visit all 39 of our homes, actually 56 of our homes with the 2 adult care and family care combined. There are 4 subcommittees needing a minimum of 8 members. Due to a loss of our CAC members this past year, there are only 2 left, me and my partner. So that means that for this calendar year, 3/4 of the homes in the county have not been visited at all. There's nobody to do it. We need help. I've been able to speak to some groups as well as individuals trying to recruit new members, but so far the results have not been very good. At this point, we know we have 1 new recruit coming on board, but that's 3 out of a minimum of 8, and it's far better if we have more than that. So since you appoint us as our county commissioners, I'm hoping you can assist us in rebuilding the CAC so that we can cover all of our homes and stand up for the rights of the nearly 900 residents who live in them. What we do is so important, and we really would appreciate any help that you can provide in getting those folks to repopulate our committees. And I thank you for listening, and if you have any questions, or if anybody in the audience is interested, I have brochures and information I'll be happy to give you.
Do we know the percentage of residents we have that are from outside of Alamance County? Or is that an issue? Or
people are placed from outside of the county because some of the folks move around. One of the big issues that we are coming into contact with is more and more people from the mental health community, younger people, are coming into these homes. And sometimes they are more fluid than the older people. But we also have older people who come to be near family or whatever, things don't work out and they need to go into a facility to receive the services that they can't get at home. So probably a high percentage are from Alamance County, but certainly not all.
Brian, can we do something about that? How to get volunteers?
Yes, we've reached out to some groups already. We've worked through some of our social media aspects, but we'll be happy to reissue the call. These are very important committees, and it's a critical service to elderly folks, so we'll be sure and reissue the call for volunteers.
Well, there's training you have to go through, too.
Yes, there is a training that is done by the Area Agency on Aging over in Kernersville, and then Kim is assigned to our county at present to work with us, and we meet with her quarterly to review everything that's gone on that quarter. In terms of time that it takes, basically I would say I spend at most 20 hours a quarter, and that's usually grouped into a couple of days of visits and then a two-hour meeting for our quarterly meeting. So we can visit during the workday. Sometimes we have people who are working people, not retired like me, and their time is more restricted, and they may visit on a weekend. And so the main thing is to go during business hours where people are not being put to bed and staff is occupied or the administration isn't there for us to speak to, we do an exit interview and bring up any concerns that we have with them.
So your contact is the Kernersville number, is that?
That is one of the starting places. The other starting place is your website where the application is. But people can go from either end, they're gonna end up interacting with both.
Now, have you contacted some of the faith-based community to try to get in some of the churches to see if there are volunteers? And
I have done it in my own church. You know, I wear three hats with the volunteering with the county and the Area Agency on Aging. I'm also my church's volunteer secretary, and I'm secretary of Alamance Corral. I can't do it all. That's why I got
pretty amazing doing all three of those.
I did go to the Meals on Wheels breakfast this week and address that group of 150 or so folks, and I'm doing interactions with whoever I get a chance to.
You're on the aging committee as well. You're on the aging committee as well.
Yeah.
Committee on Aging.
Yeah. And that the planning committee. For services for the elderly is also hurting for volunteers. We're down to 5 voting members on that. So that's another area of concern. But in terms of the CACs, the nursing home committee is doing okay. They've got enough people. It's the adult care side that we really need to focus on getting people to help us with.
How many people would you need to hit all 56 homes?
Well, we are divided. We have our homes divided into 4 groupings or subcommittee assignments. So we need a minimum of 8 of us to do the required visits. If we have extra people, it means that if somebody can't make a visit, you've got somebody that is able to. You'd still be able to make your required visit. Official visit with a second person without pulling from another committee and doubling up on their work. So it would be great to have 12, where we could have 3 people on each committee. And some of the homes we visit have the population requirement for a family care home is 6 or less. Adult care is 7 and up, and that up can be 100 beds or more. So if you have 3 people, you can, once you get in there, you can divide up and talk to more people, the more people you have on your subcommittee.
Well, on a visit, is our minimum number of residents you need to communicate with?
No, we can't. We aren't required to do a percentage or anything. You may arrive, and because we don't announce our visits, so you may arrive and find one home that I think of, a family care home. Almost everybody in that home goes out to a workshop, to an educational opportunity, something of that sort. So if you hit there and everybody's out doing things, then you may have only one person that you can talk to. On the other hand, if you go to one of the larger homes, I go to Mevin Ridge, and the last time we went there, we hit at lunchtime. And so we caught people in the lunchroom, and we could sit down with a table of four or five people, and our numbers that we were able to talk to were greater. On the other hand, you go room to room and talk one-on-one, and your numbers are less, but the information is just as valid.
Mm-hmm.
It just varies. You go with the flow.
Well, thank you so much for coming here today and being patient through this long meeting and waiting to make your presentation. Those who don't know Foxy Harper, she is a truth filler of our community, one of those unknown soldiers who's out there doing really hard work on behalf of people that does it because she loves people. And we really appreciate you.
Well, we appreciate the support that you all have given us, and especially coming to the planning committee meetings and keeping track of what's happening. One little extra political thing that I can ask you, contact your senators and ask them to vote for the Older Americans Act renewal. It passed the House last Friday. So now the next step is getting it through. That supports so many of these in-home services that we are overseeing with the planning committee, budgeting, and so forth.
I've got an email on that that enabled you to send an email to all of your representatives, senators, and House members.
Well, the House members, they've voted.
They
passed the House. So now Tillis and Burr are our focus.
Hit their mailboxes.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, Foxy. All right, we have an update on the Petrie building.
Commissioners, I'd like to introduce Mr. Perry Peterson. Perry is the Peterson Gordon Architect firm, and Perry's group is handling the planning and design and construction of the building, the Ann Ivy Petrie building, being funded by Mr. Petrie. So thank you for being here today, Perry.
Thank you.
Well, good afternoon.
Thank you.
This will definitely be an executive summary. I'm getting my iPad to work. Okay, the slide that you see in front of you is actually the view of the building if you were standing in Social Services parking lot looking back at the building. This is the site that is to the rear of the site where the dumpsters live. The dumpsters get to move out of the way so we can do something much better.
More appealing, right?
Although the dumpsters are important. They will move to a different location, but that's essentially where it goes. And essentially, the building we are doing has. Is that on?
Oh. I don't think it is, but let me go over and I'll
just figure out where I
am. Actually, it is, so we're good.
Okay.
If you'll notice, the building essentially, though, is two different brick colors and then has some entrances that are covered. And our strategy for the building has been to try to get as many square feet as possible for the agencies and make the building kind of simple. So what we're doing is the main portion of the building, you don't see it in the slide, but basically it's a building that slopes from the front to the back and has a gutter in back. So it's as simple as you can get. So we're trying to stretch the dollars out just as far as we can. I should also mention that Tracy Salisbury is here from Open Door Clinic. So she's been a great part of the planning of this building. All three users, and we're going to go kind of look at highlights of each one, have been intensely involved with the planning of the building down to where every receptacle is, every drinking fountain, you name it, they've been through. So we've done a lot of careful planning on the building. So we think the building's very attractive. The other thing we've concentrated on this building is make it very easy for the users to enter the building, because everybody is used to going to social services, and getting in that building to where you have to go is a little bit challenging. So this building's nice. There'll be parking spaces very close, and then a covered drop-off. So when it's inclement, you'll be able to get in the building very easily. So it's just it's going to be a great place for everybody to come. And from overhead, you can kind of see now from the front to the back, we just slope from the front to the back. It's a simple rectangular building, not a whole lot of tricks to it, which also saves money. Now getting to this, social services is the blue portion on the left of the screen. And that's the county agency that's going to be using the building for visitations. Open Door Clinic is in kind of the center position in the yellow. And they're currently in social services building, providing services. And then the third element is Friendship Adult Day Services, which is the purple portion. Now, the entire size of the building currently is 12,800 square feet. And through the programming, each space is able to do what they were intending to do when we kind of started the whole process. We're going to look at them a little closer. The first piece is social services. They essentially have three visitation rooms that are large kind of conference rooms. They have a place for kids to play, and they can also demonstrate kind of cooking and things of that nature, but it's for families basically to come in and be observed and have visitations. Those three meeting rooms are also joined by a conference room for viewing, and then there's a staff area where up to four people can be doing their reports and things of that nature in the building. It's contemplated, though, that the county will not have anybody there 8 hours a day, so it's really not an office kind of environment. This is just for satellite meetings. Now they have to come in the social services building, go up the elevator, down one hall, take a left, and do all this stuff to get there, and it's really something. Now they'll just be able to come to a nice new building and do their meetings. So it'll be very pleasant for them. But the middle one is Open Door Clinic, and there's a lot kind of more to what's going on there. They'll be expanding their service from what they can provide now. We've got eight exam rooms that are kind of in the center of that space. There's also two places for counseling. There's also eye exams planned. There's pharmacy.
Is the entrance at the top on that?
Pardon me?
Is that the entrance at
yeah,
the top?
Yeah, entrance is at the top.
Okay.
And there's also a pharmacy plan. So from Tracy, how many exam rooms are there now?
We have four.
Four.
So essentially double that.
Double. There's also clinic space for the folks who come in, doctors, basically do their work too. So it's a significant improvement and additional capacity to that particular program. We've got a whole workflow plan too that's 10 times better than putting it kind of in the building they were in. That was kind of make it up as you go and not ideal. So now they'll have an ideal setup as far as the clinic goes. Too far. Okay, next one is Friendship Adult Day Services. And they're currently on Martin Street with their program. They're serving up to 32 people in the old space. In the new space, they'll be able to expand to up to 48 people. They have a setup, though, where right now they're in a building that has this funny little L-shaped room that they all kind of meet in, and everybody hates it. So now they get to basically have a room that's planned. It's a nice, large, rectangular room, very big. It's got tremendous windows looking kind of back into the woods, so it'll be a very pleasant spot for them to be. The other thing that's really lacking at their current facility is bathrooms. The folks who use this building, that's one of the things they have to do more than normal people, and that's use the bathroom. So in this building, on that left side up and down, you see there's six individual single toilet rooms that are in the facility. So they'll get a lot of use, but there's plenty of them. And there's also naturally support spaces that we need to run the program. The other thing they do during the day is they walk around when it's not nice out there, walk around in circles. So we've got kind of, you can kind of see from the big day room, you've got the little corridor that circles around, so they'll be able to do their thing. They've got a kitchen, basically there's just kind of warming kitchen. The food is brought in, which they do now, so that'll be no different as far as that goes. And this comes under the division of the state that's over aging. They don't actually review our planning for it, although they've got a couple of people who are going to take a look at what we're doing and give us any suggestions that they might have as far as that goes. So we'll get a little input. It's just not official. So we're kind of happy about that. The other thing we wanted to update you on really is our timeline. And what we're looking at right now as we stand here today, our documents are at about 90% complete. By the 17th or 21st, we want to have the documents ready to go out to bid. And then in December, we'll receive bids, so before you have Christmas, you get to find out how much this costs. Then kind of a combination of permits and contracts and everything, somehow 2 months goes by. It always does. Everybody says, well, can't you do better than that? And the answer is no. We just can't. That's just how long it takes. So we start construction in March, which further closer we get to summer, the less trouble we have with soil and other things we get into. So we don't mind that stretching out a little bit. And then we're projecting roughly December next year being built.
Pretty ambitious.
Yeah, a lot of things have to go right. I mean, I can give you the horror stories and the whole bit on construction.
I've been there and know what you're talking about.
And we can have a contractor that'll do it in 6 months, and we've got one that'll do it in 2 years.
Do you have a guarantee clause on?
We, as we're doing this, we don't. That's a whole other thing.
Okay.
But I can make a lot of discussions about that.
What do you think is going to come in under your donation?
Right now, yeah, the donation was originally $3 million, and then Mr. Petrie's added money to it to expand the open door program. And roughly at $3.2 million, you heard the gentleman earlier say it was a lot of money for his $176 square foot house. Well, this one right now, I've got it projected in, this is the overall project cost, at roughly $230 a square foot. And that's really, what I'm using is kind of data that I collect as I bid projects all over the place, kind of trying to get a sense of where prices are at. Right now is not the greatest time to be building, because everybody's crazy busy.
For this institutional stuff, that's tight.
What we've run into, though, is on this particular building, the contractors will compete, and I think we will get a favorable price. I'm hoping to pray that, at least.
Mm-hmm.
Doing a building that's simpler to build, things of that nature, they kind of see the documents, they see what's going on. I hope to be able to come back to you with good news. So that would be the plan. Lately, I've bid 3 or 4 projects in the past 2 months. We were 3 for 4, so we felt pretty good. We had one we thought was going to be a disaster. It was okay. We had another we thought was great, and it was a disaster. So that's the bidding climate.
That's the part of it.
I have to use my discretion in trying to figure out what we're always trying to do. You don't want to sell the folks with the building short and tell them they can't do what they need to be doing. Here we're pushing it, but we think it's a good thing to do, and we can adjust a few things if need be. That essentially is kind of what I have for y'all today. I could go into a lot more detail, but I know y'all have been at it a long time.
In the design process, because the county will take this over, right, as far
That's
as maintenance?
Good. Correct.
And I'm assuming you're working with our maintenance.
Yeah, actually, Buddy comes to every meeting and has input on everything we're doing, and Sherry's been coming to every meeting.
And you are putting a pitch roof. I heard you say that, right?
Well, it's actually quarter inch per foot low sloping. So it's
right.
Not.
That's right. There is a pitch.
Right way to go.
Not flat. We don't want any more flat roofs.
No. The other thing is there's not very many things up on the roof either, which is a whole other thing. When you put holes in the roof, they tend to
be a
spot. Are the outer walls, are they sloped with the...
They're actually flat, so there is a parapet wall to hide some of the equipment. The other thing these buildings we do almost automatically, we use spray foam insulation on the walls. So it's like the insulation you put in your refrigerator is around this building, the operating costs are amazing.
Closed cell or
closed. So you'll see a building that will outperform probably anything. Yes. Yeah. Anything you've got.
Definitely the way to go. Mm-hmm.
And we'll be bringing, once the bids are in, we'll be bringing the proposals to you with a recommended construction group, and you'll have to approve the contract. But we've been very pleased working with Perry, and certainly enjoy working with Mr. Petrie too, and look forward to seeing Open Door Clinic and all the other folks in the building in December of 20.
How about the parking over there? What's the issue with that?
The way the parking goes, we're actually adding enough spaces to the parking that's there to cover both the Friendship's typical staff plus volunteers. That's about 8 spaces. And then there's another 10 or 12 spaces that Open Door will use. But folks for social services are going to be coming. They're using the back portion of the existing lot, and then the staff will be coming kind of from the buildings.
So is any parking in the proposal?
Yes, there is. And it's actually gone in. We've erosion control, land disturbing has gone into Burlington. There's a lot of things kind of in motion to make these dates.
From a maintenance perspective, have we considered polished concrete? I mean, I've seen that used up. I believe, as a matter of fact, Walmart on Garden Road just switched over to polished concrete.
What do you have?
We've got a lot of what's kind of termed LVT, luxury vinyl tile, which is instead of a tile you have to strip and wax all the time, is one you just kind of damp mop. And it's pretty tough stuff. That's what most everybody's been going to. The polished concrete actually costs more. The real trick is, if you know going in you're doing the polished concrete, you have to pay a big premium for getting somebody to place it, because it's got to be done a lot more careful because you're not covering it up.
Right.
If you don't cover it up, then it's a disaster and looks terrible and everybody's upset with it. We did a fire station that had 3 footprints and about 20 leaves in the floor, and I said, oh, that was character.
And they didn't really buy it, but
they didn't know that it was going to be polished concrete. They changed to it right after they had done it. So,
yeah. Well, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
We appreciate all that.
Okay.
Good presentation. All right, Mr. Higa, do you have a lease for us?
I do. Thanks. Good morning, Commissioners. I have for your consideration a lease for space for the Board of Elections voting machines and equipment. The Board of Elections currently stores its voting machines and most of its equipment at the Ralph Scott facility on Turrentine Street in Burlington. So what we're proposing to do is lease space and relocate all of Kathy's gear, including gear that's over here at the annex building, all to one space. Her current space is about 1,700 square feet. We'd be going to a 3,200 square foot space with this lease, that she would be able to put everything together. One good thing about the new property, it also has restrooms. The property where her equipment is now does not have access to the restroom, which is a little difficult. They're over there quite often testing machinery, so this will be much better. We are going with a year-to-year lease, and the reason I'm recommending that we do that is we really want to try to accommodate the Board of Elections staff building and their storage in our facility plan. And so if we go year-to-year, I think we'll avoid having some long-term commitment to a lease space. The new facility that we're proposing to lease is located at 378 Harden Street. It's over at the Medicap complex, and 1 year for the lease is $45,766. So for the rest of fiscal year 1920, the cost will be $29,866. These funds will come from the current Board of Elections budget. We've looked at Kathy's budget and feel that she can handle that new cost. Bottom line, I think this will be a great move for her equipment. It's in a secure place now. We'll make sure that it continues to be secured with alarms and cameras and the works, and it'll be a better quality space for her equipment and set the stage for us to do planning. What's the long-term solution for Board of Elections staff and equipment? So the lease is in the packet, so if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer.
I think we can probably build something long-term cheaper than that kind of to lease it.
I agree. I think, again, to me, this one year at a time gives us that ability to plan where to put it. I do not see this as a long term.
I'm saying that. I think you're smart by doing that. Thank you very much.
We have a motion and a second to approve that lease of space. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, HVAC project.
Yes, we do. We have in your package, you have an agreement with Edmondson Engineers for HVAC work. It's actually for design work over at the Human Service Center on Grand Hope Dell Road. Human Service Center needs some significant work done to the existing HVAC system. We have estimated that work will cost $1.5 million. And we have worked that $1.5 million project cost into the proposed $5 million loan that we're planning to do a little bit later this fiscal year. So we're planning to take out a $5 million loan later on in 1920, and these funds, $98,000, are needed to pay Edmondson to do all the design work so we can bid the project out. So we have the $98,000. We need your approval, though, because this contract is beyond my authority to approve.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that contract. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you, Mr. Hagan.
Thank you.
Sheriff, back can you do
as well? I know. Now the sheriff out of court. Back again.
I'm glad it didn't keep you.
Me too.
Do we have any public speakers who want to be heard on non-agenda items? So we don't have any commissioner responses to that. Mr. Hager, do you have something about garbage service rate increases?
Yes, you'll notice in your packet, I put it under county manager's report, we have a memo from Richard Hill. Just to put the board and the public on notice that Waste Industries and Republic Services are proposing to increase their fees for household trash. But this is allowable through the franchise agreements that exist. It'll be effective January 1st, 2020, and this is due to the fact that county landfill tipping fees will also be increasing. There's no action the board needs to take. I just wanted to make sure that we let you know this will happen, and the public will also hear via this meeting. So,
I think you said it didn't affect the end user, right?
Well, the end user will pay additional fees, but only for household trash, not for recycling.
Right. 27
a month. Yes, yes.
27 a month extra?
20 cents?
20 cents per month.
20 cents.
And that's all that I have.
Should we get billed prospectively for our trash service? So would we be receiving our bills now for the coming 3 months?
Under the franchises, they have the responsibility to let you, they bill 3 months in advance, so they should be letting you know now.
A couple of people at church told me that they had gotten a bill for $9. Do you happen to know anything about that?
There was a call maybe a week ago to my office about a number, something like that, that had to do with an error in the database. I believe it was Republic. Mm-hmm. I called and got that taken care of. If there's other ones, if you'll let me know, I'll make sure it's taken care of.
Okay.
Just to give it our contact number.
I noticed my garbage bill went up a little bit. I thought I had it with me. I was going to ask about it. And I was wondering what that was, and said that 27 cents, I think, every 3 months comes out about right. So thank you. Okay, do we have any commissioner comments today? I would make a motion that we table again, going into closed session.
I would like to make one comment.
Okay.
I would like to solicit one question or one answer from your sheriff. I could report on his hearing, because I understand it might have been interesting.
On the
on your case, yeah.
Court case. They're in Alamance County Jail, two of them, for 15-day, $500 fine, 2 years probation, and the third one is given probation but not active time, and they're not to come to Alamance County to do any protest for a period of 2 years while they're on probation.
Excellent.
Good. Mr. Albright,
yes.
Is there a problem? Do you foresee any problem with us tabling, going in a closed session to talk about the Karens Incorporated case?
I think we can wait 2 weeks. I think their attorney for the Burtons has indicated we need that much time to get his paperwork done.
Okay, so I make a motion that we table going into closed session to discuss the Karens case and to for the personnel reason that have been noticed because of the hour.
Second that.
So we have a motion and a second to table item number 14 on the agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you so much. And we're adjourned.
'Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.